Let's call the truth and taxation hearing of the Niles Public Library District to order. It is 7:12 PM on Wednesday, November 18, 2015. Diane, take the roll.
Karen?
Here.
Carolyn?
Here.
Jeanette?
Here.
Barbara?
Here.
Patty?
Here.
Linda?
Here.
Tim?
Here.
Everyone please stand and join me in reciting the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So just to make sure, is everyone who wishes to speak registered? Because I do have a list now. Just want to make sure everyone has a voice and is on the sheet. All right, thank you. Thank you all for coming. This meeting constitutes the truth and taxation hearing as required by Illinois state law. At this hearing, the public has a chance to comment on the proposed property tax levy increase. First, a little history. The levy was decreased by $1 million in 2013. As a one-year, $1 million gave back to the community. Not only was a $1 million not restored, but the levy was decreased again by an additional $220,000 in 2014. Because the levy was reduced last year, the board has the ability to raise the levy to the highest level in the past 3 years. This is the only year that increase can be made. If we do not increase the levy this year, the maximum increase next year will be CPI, which is estimated to be about $60,000, which would leave us in a deficit position in 3 or 4 years. Another decision the past board made was to spend down our special reserve, revenue funds. Each of these funds can only be spent on one specific purpose. And these purposes are the audit, Social Security, workman's compensation, unemployment, and building and site funds, which have all been expended and must be replenished at a cost of over $300,000 a year. Our last strategic plan was developed in 2011. The board needs to work with the new director, the staff, and the community to prepare a strategic plan for 2006 and beyond. We know that one of the tasks left incomplete from the last strategic plan is working with the north end of our district to give them a fair amount of library access. The trustees have a fiduciary duty to all of the 58,000 taxpayers of our district, not just the ones in the Village of Niles. We do not at this time know what else will be the focus of our next strategic plan. But if we do not increase the levy now, which we can, while we can, our planning options will be limited to figuring out which services and staff to cut, because that will be our only option. So the election results affirmed that the theme, strong library, strong community, resonated with the voters of our 41 precincts. And that drastic budget cuts are not what the voters requested. We are therefore proposing an increase amount that is significantly less than the maximum we could request of $1.2 million. The amount requested is $800,000, which will result in an increase of approximately $37 per household per year. We will reassess our funding needs next year after the strategic planning process is complete and will consider reducing the levy at that time. I have the list of registered speakers. So the Niles Public Library District Board of Trustees encourages and welcomes public participation and input. So thank you again all for coming. When addressing the board, speakers will be limited to 5 minutes per registered individual and 30 minutes overall. All speakers must maintain a respectful professional demeanor. Abusive, profane, frivolous, harassing, and repetitive comments will not be permitted. At my discretion, I may terminate the remarks of speakers who do not adhere to policy 3.28, public participation and comment at board meetings. And our first speaker, I will go down the list as numbered. is Stephen Yasal. If you would come up to the podium and...
Okay, well, I didn't expect this much tonight. But I'm glad to see that many people have come out tonight to talk about everything that's happening right now. I don't know too much about what exactly you guys are talking about tonight, but I have read a few articles online discussing that. And in my opinion, I really think that if we do go forward with this, we need to hold our employees accountable for taking care of our library. This is our one source that has literature on paper, so that's very important to me, and I think also to the community. And just the idea of timing, to have that there, have that secure, I think that would be a very good thing. And that will give more incentive to the employees to help maintain here and also improve what we have. I know there's a lot of like individual department here. And I think that can be expanded on a lot. I guess I've been with younger generations, analog, digital. That's a whole other topic, but this is an analog information resource point for the town. And I think we need to really consider that in the future down the line and how everybody takes care of their own individual tasks as part of the team. So that's all I have to say. I wish everyone well with how you.
Thank you for helping us sit in the audience and silently observe the rest of the hearing. Thank you. Mr. David?
Will you speak into the microphone so that everyone can hear?
I'm trying to read the name, I'm sorry.
That's good.
Mr. David.
I'm David Caravota, 8049 Ocanto in Niles. Every dime coming out of our local economy hurts our local economy. Basic economics is that every dollar that stands and circulates within our economy generates itself at least into another $3 or another $5, et cetera, depending on the study, depending on the economic environment. Whether you call it 13.5% or we call it $37 a household, or we call it how many candy bars, like we did at the like was presented at the last meeting. No matter how you present it, you're taking $800,000 out of the local economy and putting it into the library on top of the $5+ million that's already going to come out of the economy for the year. All right? We lose not $800,000. You're losing three times that. You're losing five times that. Because rather than me spending that money, going over to Paul's Marathon and picking up that gas, you know that $37 is going in here, along with all the other $37 I'm paying for the library. And I appreciate that. What's the justification for it? In 2013, we cut by $1 million. You should be commended, the board should be commended for that. This was the board that did it. The board that was able to function and keep this library going in 2013, from what I recall, did a very, very good job. And 2013 was quite a successful year. 2014, they cut again $220,000. And from what I remember from 2014, it was a very, very, very good year. If there is a need because there's lack of funds now, because savings were depleted, it should have been incorporated into a budget. We have zero-based budgeting. And you're able to show the people today where is this $5.8 million going and whether it's needed. And on top of that, where is the $800,000 going to go? I have the answer for the $800,000. I figured it out because I went to the last meeting. At the last meeting, you told us where that $800,000 is going to go. And here it is, going to three things. I don't know. There's no budget, there's no anticipation, there's not enough time between now and the 2 or 3 weeks to even try to figure out a budget. We have to just grab the money while we can, put it aside so it's available to us. That's right, you have a fiduciary duty to me. You have a fiduciary duty to everyone here, okay? There's also something called malfeasance. You have to know what you're doing with other people's money. And on tape at the last meeting, it was said, we don't know what we're doing with this money. But believe me, we're going to try to go ahead and figure out what we're going to do in the future. I love the library. Literature on paper, I live for it. I love it. One of the most wonderful law libraries is at our Daly Center in Chicago. I spend there a lot of time. And I love our library. Our library is beautiful. Does it cost us $5.8 million to maintain it? Should it? Should it then cost us another $800,000? Additional retirement is needed, as was commented here, in order to secure people doing their job and maybe doing a better job. My answer to that those are employees you don't want. So what we need to do, we have to be much more responsible. I am saying no to the tax increase, the levy increase. There's no proper legal justification for it. And that we reevaluate what your situation is here. Because I have a feeling that if there is not a tax increase this year, my guess is, I think the library is going to do it. Thank you.
I stated at the last meeting, 20 to 30% of the collection, if they go back out in the library, is gone. The books. If you see the stacking, they're gone. You're saying that you want to, you know, spend more money, go out further north. The thing is, you reduce the inventory. Usually when you have a reduction, that would mean also a workforce reduction. Was there a cut? No. So you remove work, but the thing is, you want to still more money. So usually when there's a cut, but we have vending machines and coffee areas. The thing is, you still don't have a plan. You stated it, well, we need wiggle room. I mean, we're going to get the money, and then we're going to have wiggle room to figure out what we want to do. And that's called a wish list. It's not a plan. What you want to do is get $800,000 and fulfill a wish list. I don't want you fulfilling a wish list with my tax money. The village did that yesterday, doing a 3.9% property tax levy. But they had a plan. They're saying where it's going for. It's going for pensions, for garbage. They know where the money's supposed to be going. That's what they're doing the tax increase for. You guys don't have to. You just want to take the money. I ask you not to do the tax hike. I mean, we spent millions on this library for restoration. You took out 20, 30% of the inventory that was in your books, the collection, and you're asking for more money. Please, again, do not vote for this increase or lower this increase, but have a plan what you're going to do with the money. You guys don't have any idea what you're going to do with the money. You're just going to shoot in the dark. Thank you for your time.
Next is Andrew Baltitz. Thank you.
Good evening to you all. I hope I get a little eye contact from you all. I want to thank you for the opportunity to address you tonight. And thank you for your service to the people of Niles. I've lived in Niles since 1964. My parents moved here. They raised 7 children. My wife and I raised 4 children here. We used to library quite a bit. My youngest is now up at Marquette. And I brought my tax bills. In 2012, I was at $10,023. last year, because I had an attorney, I only went up 25% to $12,634. She consoled me and said, well, you would have been $13,005. So I also am a parish deacon at St. John the Above. I donate over 1,000 hours a year for the service to people in this community. I can tell you right now, there's a lot of families in this town that can't put food on the table, they can't get their kids educated, they can't put gas in their cars, and every dollar you take from them is going to cause more pain in their families. I see it every week when I go visit people in their homes. $37 doesn't sound like a lot. I got a bigger house, otherwise my taxes wouldn't be this high, so I know mine's going to be more, but you know, I passed one up 75%. The gas tax in Cook County is outrageous. Just go out a few counties over and see what you're paying. The state income tax went up 75%. They lowered it to 3.75, but you know it's going back up over 4. Our Cook County sales tax is the highest in the country. It just goes on and on and on. We have, I don't know how many taxing bodies in Illinois. This state is in big trouble. We are the worst. And every tax body, whether it's a dollar, $10, $5, it doesn't matter. We have to learn to do more with less. I have my own business. My company cuts my expense allowance. I still have to pay my staff. I still have to pay the electric bill. Every year I have to do more with less. Did you ever ask anyone to volunteer here at the library? Maybe to do some of the tasks that someone that's on the payroll do. A lot of people came out tonight. This is the first time I've come to a library meeting in 51 years. So I don't know if it's important or not, but I'm here because we have to realize we have to all work together in the state to help the state get back on track. Every tax body that raises is not helping the state get back to financial health. We have the worst credit rating in the country, and you're not helping it get better. And so that's all I have to say. Again, I thank you for your service. I hope I was respectful. But think about all the poor people we have in this town, people with kids, and they got to come to St. John the Above to get food. They got to go to Main Township to get food. Go across the street to Family Services and ask them how people are doing in this town, and they'll tell you. So it's not about $37. It's about doing the right thing, and it's about doing more with less. That's what we have to learn to do with all of our governments in Illinois. Otherwise, more of us, we won't be retiring in the state. I didn't contribute to the problem. I ain't gonna stick around. If people don't get it and keep making us worse and worse, I will go somewhere else in 10 years when I retire. So thank you very much.
Jerry.
Oh, okay. Just like the other gentlemen that were before me, we definitely thank you for being involved. Public service is an important thing. I know it's not an easy thing to do. But the one thing that if I was in your position, is look at the funds as if it's your own money. It's very easy, like Mr. Firewall just said, for the various taxing entities to go raise something because they can go and raise it. I think it's a small increment, but it does affect a lot of people. I have my own business also. I have to watch out for my employees and that they have a good living and make sure that I provide for them as best as I can. That requires me, for the last 4 years, a pay cut. I give my employees a raise, not a significant raise, but it's something where I want them to be happy. So that way then we all have a good working relationship. Now when you're going to go and tax and use other people's money, it's very easy to go and spend it the way you think you want to do it. If you don't have a plan, that's bad. If I don't have a plan for my business, I know I'd be out of business. You have to have a plan to do those things. And I don't think you need to go raising it all the time. I know you're not doing this, but for a good example that the federal government does is they go and take money from Medicare to go and take care of some of the problems somewhere else. That's totally wrong. I can't do that. I can't go and take funds from my guys for 401k, go and pay for the health insurance. That's illegal. A lot of stuff done is illegal. Over here, to me, I think it's just something that we ask of you to please, you know, be good representatives of us and the money that is spent. Think of it as your own money. Would you do that the same way? And I don't think there's anything wrong with increases being tied to the CPI. Because many of us over here in this room, I'm sure, everything is tied to the CPI, and we might not even have kept up with the CPI in terms of our salaries and anything else that we might be able to do. So again, thank you for your service, but please consider this as if it's your own wallets, as if it's your own money. It's very important. Thank you very much.
Rich Horsky.
He is here, but he asked me to speak for him. He's unable to speak tonight, so he gave me his thing.
And the last gentleman was Jerry. Okay, so I'm going to show them. Thank you.
So Rich Horsky has been a resident of Niles for 15 years. And he's saying here.
Excuse me, I'm sorry, can you state your name?
Oh, my name is Berta Zalesny.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. My Pappy once told me that if you don't do it right the first time, don't do it at all. And boy, I see a lot of library members here tonight that should smell the coffee and do the right thing before it's too late. And find out the good people of Niles are not going to stand for taxing of any source that does not make any sense, such as the library. Do the right thing. It's absolutely inflated, unnecessary, and unreasonable number. And it saddles the citizens of Niles with a crazy number, 13.2%. That increase is unheard of in this day and age. Yes, everything is going up, but I rarely hear 13.2%. Absolutely unacceptable. You haven't planned, you haven't done homework. You haven't looked at alternatives to this 13.2% increase. You have the same amount of tax levy as last year. And you also have a $12 million surplus that I saw the forms on as of, I believe it was July 31st or June 31st. So there's $12 million sitting out there for you. Why do you need 13.2% increase? Tim, I'm not picking on you, but I wanted to let you know that there was an email that I saw that you wrote, and it said, one of the things was that Carolyn, one of our other members here, talks only a lot about cut, 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 but she doesn't give you any specifics.
Sounds like
you're looking at it. I'm not looking at it. That's what I read. Everything goes by what I see and what I hear. I don't want to make anything up, so that's why I do that. Tim, are you a passive bystander? Are your people on board passive bystanders? Carolyn is mentioning it. Yeah, I'd like to hear about that, but all of you have that responsibility to find out what are the problems here. There's got to be something that you can look at that will help decrease waste. There's waste everywhere. In my own corporation, there's waste. I know it's there. Sometimes you just have to go look for it. I would be glad to help you find it if you need any of that help. What you're doing is analogous to a war. You're dropping a nuclear bomb onto the village without first planning a less destructive strategy. $800,000, it's a huge number. It's absolutely outrageous and huge, and it's for no good reason. I went on the Niles Library website, and I also read the goals that you have for the library, and I was surprised to see that only one of you, and I won't mention who it is at this point, had marked out, said anything about being fiscally responsible. They were, and they were all very nice, but I would have loved to have seen more of that. I want to do these great things, but I want to do them in a fiscally responsible way, and I was kind of disappointed to see. I was at Gulf Mill when the debates occurred, and I remember hearing about beautiful libraries and wonderful strong libraries such as you mentioned. My problem is I didn't hear anything about a 13% tax increase to do it. People don't always equate one with the other, and I'm sure if you got up there and said that you were just ready to go ahead and tax with no plans or anything, then there might have been a different outcome to that election. And maybe that's our own fault for not asking questions of all board members. Every party, whether you're on the village board, the park, whatever, we should be asking these specific questions. You said you have a mandate practically today when we were talking at the beginning to raise taxes. You don't have a mandate. You were voted in to give us a strong labor. It does not always equate with money. And I don't believe for one minute that anybody, most of the people on this board would come back next year and increase the tax levy, to be honest with you. Regarding just two quick little things regarding the Northern Corridor, I did some very quick research, so I may have missed something, and I apologize for that. I could only find one library that has a branch, and that was out of this one. There may be others. I tried to look at Schaumburg, looked all different places, could only find one. So it's not like a real popular thing. Finally, I am asking you to listen to the concerned citizens and rethink your position on this important issue. 13.2%. Thank you. Was the TIF district that was proposed by the Village of Niles. And you, as the library district within that TIF district, were invited to the joint hearing. I asked that night about it, and the attorney, Mr. Walsh, had received some piece of information, correct? And the hearing was due June 25th. And the librarian, Ms. Lemke, she knew something about it but wasn't sure. The library board, as a group, never made a decision about whether you, as a taxing body within the TIF, should support the TIF. So you never voted on it. You never said, yes, that's good for the Village of Niles, or no, it's not good for the residents of the Village of Niles. So I went to the hearing on June 25th, and you weren't represented. And the people who were there said, and there were just four out of all the taxing bodies, they voted to recommend the TIF district, the new TIF district, on Toohey Avenue. And what that new TIF district, because Ms. Matthias, as a trustee of the Village of Niles, voted to support that TIF district, that TIF district will be in effect for 23 years. And what that means for all the rest of you is that your library taxes are going to automatically go up for the next 23 years whether they pass this 13.1% additional tax levy or not. So your taxes have already been raised in the library district for the next 23 years, regardless of what they do here tonight. So you really don't want to be raising taxes more than you have contributed to by not attending the TIF meeting and not voting as a board to not support taxing all these people in the library district for 23 years. You do not need this raise in taxes, and I really believe that if you do need to raise money in the future, you can have a referendum. There was no talk about that here earlier. It was as if you don't do this right now, you won't ever have to do anything more with raising the taxes and putting money in the funds that I guess you've drawn down. But you certainly need a plan, and a plan is not to raise taxes for these people tonight by 13.1%. Remember that the county is going to reinstitute that 0.25% tax on the county as of January 1st. So in addition to the 0.25% that the Village of Niles has, which most people don't, which was put into effect when the county tax was removed, we in the Village of Niles will have the highest sales tax anywhere around. Thank you.
Andy Mikowski?
Yes, thank you.
Mr. Tomasz Mikowski, yes, 1348 West Neal, Niles. I pretty much want to say all of the stuff that other people basically said, except one thing. If you said that you need to increase that value of the money you need for whatever you need. This library got renovated in such a beautiful state and state with that $1.2 million less. So if you really know how to do this the same way with even less, okay, then maybe you should not sit up front of us. Maybe you should have somebody else with you. Okay. Like everybody else said here before, it's very easy to control somebody else's money. Most of us actually struggle to make daily basis. We go through different kind of concepts, bankruptcy, modification of all kind of crazy stuff. Whatever that lady said, it's completely insane. If you have the heart, make the right decision, okay? But think about if you can watch the strength to the people's eyes in the future. Because things turn around, sometimes right or wrong. Sometimes you're on the top and someone is on the bottom, and you never know when and how. God bless you all.
Village meeting last night, got our taxes raised over there. They lowered it by 1%. Still not happy with that. Got a number of phone calls from a number of different people. They're not happy. I also got a phone call from the mayor. He told me he was feeling well. He couldn't make it tonight. I didn't think he wanted to be in a room with all you people. But overall, when I see this board, you guys are the poster child of what's wrong with government. I mean, you disregard what people have to say. You got elected. Everyone's shocked. Everyone is shocked as to what you guys want to spend and what you want to do. Other libraries built in the northern corridor, kiosks, this whole vision of just spend, spend, spend. And we do not want to support it. It's very simple.
Please keep a respectful tone. Thank you.
Well, anyways, okay. Andy, to answer your question, there's over 6,900. And 64, I think, taxing bodies in the state of Illinois. We have more than any state in the union. And that's what's wrong with this. And what I would also propose is we have to take a look at getting rid of this taxing bodies. Maybe the village library should not have taxing powers. Go back, take it back to the people, and we gotta start somewhere. But that's the way I feel about the whole state. Cook County, I'm a two-time loser because I live in Cook County in the state of Illinois. If I lived in Chicago, I'd be a three-time loser. But this library should be run as a business. It's not somebody's personal spending account. Vote no on the tax levy. No increase.
Dale Zilligan, 8419 Chester, been in Niles since 1988. First time I've ever got up and spoke to you people. I remember back when I was in eighth grade, you know, taking government that basically you elected people to do your wishes so that you didn't have to have everybody vote on everything. I've talked to a lot of people. I've taken and got a petition signed. Not one person. Not a single person said, yes, I think we need more taxes that we need, that our library needs to grow and needs more funds. Everybody goes, "God, I get along with less." I'm an engineer for a school district. I get along with half the people I had 4 years ago. And those people get less money because we hire them from the outside. They're not employees of the school district anymore. Maybe everybody ought to look at that. You can give people to work for a whole lot less because a lot of people need jobs. Now, we elected you as our representatives. Shouldn't you do what we, the people, elected you to do or want you to do? Or do you have your own agenda, self-supporting, that we have no say on once we elected you? So we made a mistake. Maybe there needs to be a recall. Maybe we need to do something. More people need to stand up because government in all branches is on a runaway. And we, the people, are the only people supporting it. Nobody here, you don't make a dime here. And I'm going to tell you one thing. We're going into a digital age. You want to expand into digital. You want to teach classes. You want to have all this fancy digital stuff. You borrow out DVDs. I don't know one kid that needs a lesson in how to watch a movie. What's going down in our day? Our reading scores. Reading, basic reading is what we need. We don't need all the other programs. Get back to basics. Reading, writing, and arithmetic. You don't need to expand. Do more with what you have or less. That's my view.
Jerry's to be asked 8:31.
Sign in.
6:31.
Come on,
Jerry. Come on.
Come on.
I was asking, does anybody else want to talk?
There was two sign-in lists. It was confusing.
Okay, I'm sorry. That's why I wanted to ask. I want to make sure everyone has a voice.
Thank you. Jerry Sapansky, 6:31 West Dobson, Niles, Illinois. First of all, I'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight. There's been a number of us that were here for the last four meetings. And if you're interested in what's been said and to really believe it, please go to the www.vniles.com, go under Community Services, the library, and under the foyer, you will see meeting packets. You will see videos of the last four, five meetings. Okay? Some of them are long. If you don't believe anything you've said and what's been said is accurate, go watch these videos. One, it's factual because it's on videotape. You'll see what trustees are concerned about expenses. You'll see what trustees don't really, in my mind, give a damn. Okay? Watch the videos, if anything, for entertainment. You'll see what a fiasco has been going down here in the village when it comes to expenses. As far as Ms. Ryan, I'll speak to you personally on you. For the past three meetings, you used a verbiage that you were elected and that many, many people wanted to have more programs and improve programs. You have no factual data to substantiate that. Yes, you won the election, but don't make a statement they wanted more programs, better programs. That's not factual. That's your interpretation. Three people could have said it to you. That doesn't mean everything. Okay? Then you guys were talking about specifically a northern branch. Beautiful thinking. You know, maybe in my 72 years of living on this earth, I might have the urge to go ice skating indoors. I don't want to drive all the way to the other end of town. So why not build an ice skating rink right here for my convenience? That would be nice.
okay? And it wouldn't cost $800,000, I would take it as a fire hose, okay? The last thing, I just looked at tonight's comments, and there were public comments section, and there was a lady, I assume it was a lady, that says, you know, it would be nice if the library had sewing classes. And I looked at that, and the response was, yes, we'll look into that. What the previous gentleman said addresses that fact. The definition of a library is changing, we all realize that. But we don't need sewing classes, we don't need 25 computers, and I've been in here four times in the past 2 weeks, three people sitting at them. The rest vacant, we don't need 3D printers. Let's use a library for what it was meant to be, okay? Books, learning, you don't need all these expensive programs. And for your $800,000, I say no. Last meeting, there was a reference that, it's just a candy bar or two. Well, tonight, I'm bringing in my tax payment.
If you could actually explain to us, if that's possible, how you came up with the $37 out of that $800,000 based on each individual or each household?
I'm sorry, but there's no comment. It's just public hearing for
you. Oh, okay, then.
So on behalf of the Board of Trustees.
Wait, he has hand up.
Sorry.
Hi.
Do I get to keep this?
to them.
I did sign in. Maybe I signed in the wrong sheet. Jack Achille. I'm at 8454 North Chester.
I'm sorry, may I spell your name, please?
A-C-H-I-L-L-E.
A-C-H-I-L-L-E.
Mike Achille. Gotcha. I'm one of the lucky ones in a row. I live next door to Bob. I didn't think I was going to be speaking here today, and there have been a lot of specifics given, and I don't have a lot of specifics, but there's a few things that I do know. 1987, bought my first house in Niles, $97,500. 2 weeks after we moved in, we brought my daughter home from the hospital, started my family. We lived in Niles for 10 years, then we moved out to Vernon Hills. We were gone for 17 years. We came back to Niles about 15 months ago or so. And I built a beautiful house, prepared for my older years. We built a ranch home, so I wouldn't have to deal with the stairs. I have some bad issues with my legs. So, you know, you plan for these things and you try to do the right thing. My daughter, who was born, that we brought her home from the hospital in 87, she just bought a house in Niles on Oquito. And I have an 11-month-old grandson. And we helped her to buy the house, and now we're trying to do a few things around there. And it's a little bit, you know, we can't spend money on this, honey. So we have to work within a budget. You know, she wants to do this in the place, she wants to do that. But, you know, even if it's a little bit more money, it's $100 or $200, it all adds up. And my basic point is this. You take the government, from the federal government, the state, the local, and you did a great job of it when you, your introduction tonight. You were explaining it, it sounds great, but it always sounds great. And yet, the government's in my pockets and everybody's pockets all the time. I mean, I just can't help but think of when I was a teenager driving my 1970 convertible and the toll was 15 cents or 30 cents. And how that, and that's not even supposed to be around. The tollway was only supposed to be around once they built the roads, but it stayed. The mentality of government is always more money, take it in, and then you figure out what you're going to do with it. And I think that's just the wrong mindset. That's all I have to say.
On behalf of the Board of Trustees, I thank the members of the public who have come to speak. I will now entertain a motion to adjourn the truth and taxation hearing.
Linda.
Can I make a correction? Jerry, you can go on the website, however, you said bniles.com, it's nileslibrary.org to look at all our minutes.
You can go to bniles.com, go under Community Services, you'll find the Niles Library District. You can click on that and do what I said, you go to the FOIA section and you will get the information that you want. And it will direct you to another URL if you want to go and watch videos also.
You know, the other way with the video is very easy. Go to the Niles Library website, go all the way to the bottom where it says YouTube, click on it, they all pop up right in front of your face.
I will now entertain a motion to adjourn the truth and taxation hearing. It is Monday. PM on Wednesday, November 18, 2018. Diane, please take the roll.
Yes.
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 Okay, the first item on the agenda is the presentation of the library's annual audit. Judy Walker from our auditing firm, McClure and Sarah, is here to present. Judy?
Okay, so I draw your attention to the independent auditor's report. It's officially on page one. The library has received a clean opinion. That is, we've issued an unmodified report. So your financial statements are in accordance with general accepted accounting principles, presented fairly in all material respects. What this audit report also does, it states what management's responsibilities are, and that is that management is responsible for the financial statements. We as your auditors are responsible for the audit of the financial statements. So that being said, move to page three through five is management's discussion and analysis. It's a high level look at the financial picture of the library. And it also affords the opportunity of having some comparative information in there. Nowhere else will you see that in the report. So the financial highlights, as of June 30, 2015, the net position of the library is $23,568,306. And that is on a full accrual basis of the county. This is an increase from the previous year of $287,869. Of that $23,568,306, $706,373 is restricted. $12,468,316 is invested in capital assets. And $10,393,617 is unrestricted. Then moving to page four, you have a condensed statement of net position. Here's the comparative information I had referred to earlier. Current assets are up about 5%. This represents basically cash investments and accounts receivable. So it's up about $547,000. And you have your capital assets of $12 million. Current liabilities of $454,546. Not much of a change from the previous year. And you will notice there is no non-current liability this year. At the end of 2014, you had $200,500 that was accrued as of June 30. That was for those retirement obligations. Agreements that were signed as of June 30, effective as of June 30, so that was all accrued in 2014. Now it's being paid out in 2015, and 2016, 2017. So then your next section there under the statement of net position is your net position, the investment in capital assets, restricted funds. Again, the restricted funds of $706,000, that is all your special revenue funds combined. The next table down is the condensed statement of activities. Property and replacement taxes are down 4% from 2014. I'm still on page four, still looking at the comparative. So property and replacement taxes are down 4%. It's about $236,000. As we heard previously, that is the decrease in your tax levy, extended tax levy from 2013 to 2014. You'll notice net interest income is up about three times what it was last year. There's been some better use of, or better investment, I guess you might say, or different investments, moving from MaxSafe CDs to more of their securitized CDs. So earning quite a bit more money there and laddering out. So
those investments are still legally permitted.
Absolutely, yes. It's all still CDs. Just finding a better
return.
Yeah, and also you extended your the terms on your investments. You changed your investment policy to allow 5-year CDs, and so consequently you can earn a little higher interest rate. So overall, your total revenues are down about 3% from the previous year. Looking at the expense section, personnel is down about $600,000. And I know, just for a fact, looking at your headcount from June 30, 2014 to June 30, 2015, it's down 6 people. And most of that is that retirement benefit. I know there were 5 people that left because of that. So when you have that drop in salaries, it also falls down to that employee fringe benefit line too. You'll see a decrease there as well. Operating costs are up a little bit. You had some consulting costs this year, a little under $100,000. So that's primarily the reason for the increase in that line item. In the other caption is insurance, Social Security, building maintenance. It's all your special revenue funds, basically. And those were down just a little bit. Then you have depreciation, non-cash item. Capital outlay, again, you spent more than $10,000, but this is what was not capitalized. Okay, so these are the smaller items that did not get capitalized. So total expenses overall at $5,902,000 is down 10.5% from 2014. So all in all, then you end up with a net increase of $287,869 for year ended June 30, 2015. So moving to page 5. Page 5, that top table, is the change in your funds. Okay, what we looked at previously was government-wide, so that took into account any long-term assets, long-term liabilities. Your fund balances are on a modified accrual basis, so it's more your short-term. Short-term assets, short-term liabilities. And this exactly equals what you saw in your monthly financials as of June 30, 2015. There were no adjustments to your June 30 financials. So in the general fund, there was a decrease of $184,710, and that was after the $1,002,000 was transferred to special reserve. Okay, so special reserve is really the only fund that sustained an increase for the year. The rest of your funds are all down. You purposely didn't levy as much in your special reserve funds, trying to draw down those fund balances, so you see all of those are showed a deficit this year. All in all, your general fund has, in its fund balances, about 14 months of expenditures. And special reserve funds are down from 19 months. They have now at 18 months. So they're also decreasing, so that's good. Budgetary highlights, your general fund expended $5,131,957, which was $5,702,855 less than the appropriation of $10,834,812, which is your little spending limit, so you were far below that. So that's all good news. Not too much excitement in capital assets this year. After the renovation years, there's about $120,000 of fixed assets that were a net increase in fixed assets this year. sure, absolutely, that's... No, that's all I was really going to cover, I really wanted to focus on the front part of the statement.
Could I get a copy?
Absolutely.
From the funding also, for the special funds. And the special reserve fund, $1.1 million transferred into it, is that...
$1.2.
$1.2, that came from the general...
Came from the general fund.
So we drew that out to put, to make sure...
Yeah, it's just a wash between those two funds, yes.
All right, so for not for that transfer, those funds would have gone down about $1.8 million altogether, right? They went down because of not using those funds.
Well, the general fund would have had an increase of about $1 million. The special reserve would have had a decrease of about $100,000. It's a wash between the two.
Oh, I'm sorry, I see what you're saying.
You know what, if you want to see it, is that a picture? If you turn to page seven, you can see the transfer.
Okay.
Okay, this is the statement of revenue and expenses with all your major funds, and then other funds, all your other special revenue funds in a columnar form. So if you look all the way down at the bottom, under excess deficiency of revenues over under expenses, you're going to see your transfer line item. And so that gives you a clear picture of what the fund, the net surplus was before the transfer. You see that? Yeah, page seven, bottom page seven. So general fund had a surplus of $1,015,298. And then the $1,002,000 was transferred to special reserve to fund balance. Okay, so the operating transfer by nature is truly just a wash between the two. Yeah, an increase in one and a decrease in one. Any other questions?
I have one. One of the taxpayers alluded to, something about having $12 million in cash and receivables at the end of last year. I think you mentioned in your report something about available cash, or what would you say we now have available in terms of cash on hand?
Okay, turn to page six. This is your balance sheet and statement of net position. So balance sheet refers to the modified accrual basis. Statement of net position is at par right now. And full accrual basis. So that first line under assets, cash and investments, you can see how much of a balance you have in each of the funds, and it totals to $8,970,673.
So right now we have $8,970,673 on hand. And then I have another question.
One second, let me just piggyback on that. Which is how many months and
expenditures?
Leave you 7 1 year.
Well, when you do that calculation, you really look at fund balance to total expenditures. Your fund balance in the general fund is $6,146,000, so it's quite a bit lower than the cash. That cash and investment line has the first installment of the levy. So
right now, with the first installment, we have $8,900,000. Mm-hmm. We hope to receive some more revenues. We can't guarantee when we receive them, but we are not in dire straits either. I mean, based on this, I think if we did some creative accounting, or maybe did some accounting, we might be able to save the taxpayers some money. I did have another question. I read your cover sheet about what an auditor's responsibility is, and it sounds like you audit our records, but there's no connection between what you observe or maybe any conversations you would have with our staff, like based on, I don't know, staffing of $3 million, just throwing it out there, you would recommend that these expenses should be a certain percentage of that. Like, you don't have any of those conversations with them. That's not your role, correct?
No, well, you know, the job of the auditor is to obtain third-party evidential matter,
to support the numbers in your balance sheet and income statement, basically. We look for, you know, approvals, we look for authorization, we make sure that everything is properly recorded, and most importantly, you look for that third-party verification. So, like for salaries, for instance, we go, we obtain all of the tax reports, tie out to penny, your salary, someone is going to pay, report it to the IRS. Bottom line, that's, I don't give a subjective opinion about whether or not that's too high or too low. But dollars and cents, I can tell you that everything ties up perfectly. So, yeah, so.
Well, and then just one last thing. There was a comment made, I believe President Ryan mentioned that you suggested that when we fought over the levy about raising it, she mentioned our auditor suggested we increase it, and I was wondering what your thoughts were on that.
Increase the revenue funds after we yes, spend them down, thank you. So in the past, we had to spend down, we had more months. You suggested how many months? I know you had like a
rule of thumb,
right,
range.
Right. You know, 12 months is enough.
Well, spending right. Down
so we,
is what you do.
With. Right, yes. So we didn't, so we spent them down, and that's fine. And then we knew that we were spending them down, and we did a different way to go.
So you did not
always.
Suggest.
So we.
Okay, thank you.
No, that's not the part.
I didn't think it was, but it did come up. Thank you so much.
Sure. I did want to also talk about what's not here, and that is a management letter. You know, like I said, we've got some history with business managers in the past, and we've had some lengthy audit, management letters that have stated material weaknesses that needed to be corrected. We've had lots of advisory comments helping you to shore up your systems and make things more effective and more efficient. And we have a close eye on your internal controls to make sure that all your systems are documented. That then we test them to make sure that you are actually following what you say you are doing, and then we look at them, evaluate them for effectiveness. We have no management letter this year, so you know your staff is to be applauded. There were no adjustments that we had to make ourselves. They were all given to us, all the information that was necessary to put the financial statements together. Your staff is. I got to tell you, there's not a whole lot of my clients that don't get a management letter, so yeah. It's always, I think it's value added to an audit. It's a requirement if there's material weakness, but it's also value added for you. And your staff's doing a good job.
So this is the second year that we have not had. So.
Oh yeah, they used to be. They just lost. So.
Right.
Yeah. So that's a good thing.
I just have one other.
Sure.
Near the end of the fiscal year, we changed the facsimile signatures on the checks. How do you view that change? Does it weaken our internal controls and checks and balances?
When this question came up, I think it first was an email, and we were emailing back and forth, Greg and I, and finally, when there was too many questions, we got on the phone and just started, because you're right, it can be a concern. You've got to look at all the controls that are behind it. The actual signing of the check is an important process, an important procedure, but what it is evidence of is the review of that check. Okay, the review of the check is the most important thing. Now, once a check is signed, then you worry about security. So that was more my concern. I wanted to make sure the check stock was securely locked and no two people knew where the keys were. And the systems that generate the signatory on the check, make sure that those are password protected and, on and on. I mean, we looked at all the controls surrounding what happens when you do a facsimile signature. So, all that said, being said, I don't think you are losing any control over the review process because the review is still is being done via PDF. I mean, the checks are being reviewed by Tim. And I know there's lots of communication back and forth. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Barbara, you have to review that. That's right. So Treasury Secretary. So no, I don't think anything has been lost. I'm confident that the controls are secure behind the scenes. That, you know, maybe it's not so evident to everybody else, but what's more important is that the job of the board is still doing their review of those checks. So, no, I'm confident that we have looked at it backwards, forwards, and sideways for you, and it's modern. And I'm getting one dry.
Okay, there you go. Make sure you're comfortable. There you go.
Thank you. So, no, I don't feel that it's a problem, and I must tell you, you are not the first to do it. Most of my libraries have actually signatories. So we audit 20-plus libraries, and so we have a pretty good feel for what the rest of the library world is doing, at least in the Chicago area. So, yeah.
I think I'm going to have to go back to one of my original questions. Was when we had talked in the past about how much money had to be in those revenue funds that were, they're not gray, they're black, you cannot switch the ones back and forth.
Correct. Those are, you're still
right. And,
that's right.
I want to say it was 3 or 4 years ago, possibly. And there was quite a bit of money in there. And there was a statement that was said too, that we had, I think that was one of our controls to bring that money lower, right? To spend that money down.
Well, yeah, because you're going to tax objectives.
Right. So that was one of our objectives at the end of one of your presentations. So I just want to state that was a suggestion, and that is what we did.
Okay.
But we spent it down so low that we did now.
Well, your Social Security fund is the one that's probably lower than it only has about 2 months of expenses in it, so you're probably going to fund that fund this year.
Okay.
And
you said you wanted, rather than just a few months, you feel you should give at least a year's?
Well,
I think it was around 6 months or so.
You know, that's
six to eight.
Healthy,
I think you
guys five different people, you did five different years.
Yeah.
I hate giving a
judgment. Right.
Yeah. You know, I have some clients that have 6 months, and I have printed, oh boy, you know, Cook County is late, there's not going to install them, you start running into potential cash issues. 2 years is too much,
right.
So, right. You know.
Somewhere between 6 months and a year.
Right. But there was discussion, and it was,
I made a different answer.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's a, you know, it's not a, there's not a finite answer.
Right. So clients that don't get the tax revenues at the time, sometimes you have to take out tax administration forms?
Generally, there's enough in the general fund, and some have even gotten rid of their special revenue funds once they spend them down, because it becomes burdensome just to track all those levies,
right.
And then with the general fund, and how much that is. You can't do it without a bill to spend them down, essentially.
Agenda is the consent agenda. A is to approve the minutes of the regular board meeting of October 21st, 2015. B is to approve the minutes of the special board meeting of November 5th, 2015. And C is to approve the payment of the bills for operating expenses of $192,244.48 payroll expenses of $269,825.31, special reserve expenses of $0, for a total monthly expense of $462,049.79. I would like to entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved. Karen? Any discussion?
We need a correction.
Sure.
The regular board meeting, October 21st, go to page 3, where we had discussion on tax levy at the public library. It says, Mr. Chris presented board, blah, 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 blah. A discussion was held, and the board agreed to determine on the tax levy. The whole board did not agree.
I'm concerned. Where are you reading, on the third page?
Third page, if you go under, it's under the new business, but where we spoke on discussion on the tax levy, right above unfinished business.
Oh, where it says board agreed to determine on the tax levy, had a special board meeting on November 5th.
Right, the whole board did not agree to determine the tax levy.
So would you say a majority of the board agreed to determine?
Just list the names. That'll make it easy. Just list who did and who didn't.
I think the issue is sending the dates.
Questions about some of the items on the check register. Could we discuss them now? So it's part of the payment, correct?
Yes.
All right. For the past several months, I know we haven't really sat down and talked about the checks, but I've noticed some vendors that we seem to use repeatedly, and I'm not sure what they're for. For example, in this month's register for November, there's Cooperative Computer Service for $5,590. I was wondering what that's for.
We belong to a consortium called the consortium of that name, and we pay a monthly fee so that they maintain our catalog and they maintain all of the accounts for all of the residents of all the patrons of the library. That's for standard for several years.
So they maintain a catalog of what information?
It's CCS. It's our CCS catalog. It's the database of all of our patrons and all of our materials.
And that seems to vary from month to month. I think in October, it was $22,000. So is there a yearly fee, and somehow you just decide?
That was the yearly fee last month.
And if you look at the
so
months,
what's the yearly total?
It's about $100,000. If you look at the months preceding that.
Okay, so this is CCS. I didn't remember. remember what this was.
If you look at the months preceding that, there were no charges because they were late for late us. So the $22,000 is a catch-up.
Well, there's, I see a charge every month that I went back 3 months. And I do see them listed a few times. There's, so I don't know when they didn't charge us, but I mean, I didn't know what $5,000, $22,000, but you're right. CCS would be with Cooperative Computer Services. Okay, that's great. And then there were a few others. Today's Business Solution seems to be popping up a lot.
Today's Business Solution is also called CBS. For services related to training by patrons and the interactivity between the computer system and the reservation system for computer terminals and things like that.
We pay for patrons to print to the tune of $6,000 a month?
No, that is likely okay.
Okay, that was last month.
We just upgraded all of that equipment. They put in, you remember, you signed up on the new copiers and the equipment that went with it? Yeah.
So I thought the, that was the equipment or that was just some sort of service?
That, if it was months previous, it was the equipment.
It was in October. I thought the equipment that we purchased was out of the special reserves.
What?
Okay, because there's no notation that this was special reserve. What I see from special reserve was Kona Kamenota Business. And that came out of special reserve for $25,000.
Yeah.
So I thought that would be the equipment. That's why I wondered what was this $6,000.
I think the $5,000 was it's a little unit that goes on the top of it. That's where you put in how many copies you want, and it's where you get your print job. It's all the software to send the print jobs back and forth.
$6,651 was for a piece of equipment then?
Well, there was several pieces.
And then the $25,000 came out of reserves for, what was it?
The copier. The copiers were printers. So those copier printers, you know, they're all out of place.
All right, and then actually there are quite a few different charges, and I wasn't sure if it was technology or printing, and they seem to continue, so if you could just bear with me. There's something called Spotlight Incorporated, which pops up every month. I was wondering who that is. It's $3,250 in September, in August, and then September is 800. Do we know who they are?
Oh, they're an electrician.
Okay, so we've been an electrician out here.
Yeah, when we reconfigured the coverage to accommodate digital services, we get the hassle much for the services.
So they've been out
here
for 3 months or beyond?
Yes.
Okay. I have to admit, I saw the comment bill went down to $8,647.
That's because it's been colder outside.
So have we been able to determine what our new equipment may be doing as far as taxing our electric bills? And you were going to look into our lighting?
I don't have, because I wasn't here and because it wasn't collected, I don't have usage reports on the lighting that existed prior to the renovation. But I can tell you that in the first part of 2013, we were paying ComEd an average of between 6 and 8 cents per kilowatt. In the middle of 2013, about July or August, it went up to 8 to 10 cents per kilowatt. At that point, trying to buy power from outside of Commonwealth Edison and just pay Commonwealth Edison for the distribution network that they already have.
Right.
But the consultants that we contacted did not see an advantage to arbitrage those rates. So unfortunately, for the time being, start with 8 to 10 cents per kilowatt hour.
So it's gone from 6 to 8 and maybe 10, but is our usage increasing?
Our usage is pretty much flat. There was a dip in the usage during the construction period. Certain parts of the library were shut down.
So there's been no increase. There's been no increase with our new equipment. The is it your green screen or your
No, the green screen doesn't use electricity.
Nothing. There's no increase in electricity for that 3D printer.
Nothing measurable.
So we just think it's going up because the price of electricity went up. Our usage is not changing.
No, usage is pretty consistent.
Okay.
But I do want to caution you that during the construction period, which was virtually all of 2013, a large part of the library at any given point in time had the lighting removed and was not in the soft limits of the patrons while the construction crews were in here doing their work. So we see a slight increase during that period of time, and then it comes back to normal levels.
So 2 cents more per, what is it, kilowatt, whatever it's
called? Kilowatt hour.
Is it $2,000 per month increase or 2,500?
2 cents over 8 cents is a 25% increase.
And you think that it's been a little cooler, so that's why it's dropped. But
yes.
There's no reason to check into any of our lighting or anything.
And I'd be happy if there's a light that you'd like to have checked.
I'd like to know if the new lights that are used in all the renovations came with any information from the architects in terms of their efficiency. Usually today, anything you buy comes with efficiency information. And I think that was what we talked about before the electric bill went up.
But
that you were going to look into.
I'd be happy to get that information.
But what I'm trying to say is the electric bill increased before Edison raised their rates, so maybe we should consider both. I mean, we've talked about this for so long, and now, you know, we make all these other comments about, oh no, we decided we didn't want efficient light bulbs. You know, that all came after the fact. But, you know, we talk about things, they don't go in the minutes, and then we never get to, you know, sit down and really look into things.
Can I say something? When we were doing the renovation, there were board members that said we are not going to be looking at efficiency. They wanted to look at the cost overall.
Well, I do recall.
And I just wanted to state that.
I do recall.
There were some of us who wanted to spend a little more to get efficient.
Okay, I don't know.
So I think this has really been talked about.
But
a
recently,
lot. We would like to put that in the strategic plan once we get to it.
Okay. Apparently, there's nothing to put into the strategic plan. According to Greg, it's just an increase in the cost of the electric bill. So maybe we can save the next year some money.
Maybe we don't need to. Well,
okay.
That's a good idea.
All right, a couple other things. PLIC Grand Island, is that some kind of
sense of life insurance?
Oh, it's insurance. And we pay, okay, I never would have guessed that's what that is.
Well, we know because I had to ask a couple of months.
Okay, and then I have a question. I didn't get a chance to really talk about the weekend when, what was it called? Underground weekend when but you showcased all the new rooms in the lower level. I was wondering if we had entertainment there, or is the entertainment I'm seeing, like some marionettes and some other companies, are those people that we hired for like programs? Is that how we do that?
Well,
or did you have something that weekend?
We have a program, a family program on the second Sunday of every month. We have that for like 10 years now.
Mm-hmm.
And so that money gets paid out to youth services program line most of the time.
So like Dave Herzog's Marionettes, that's the program you always
correct. That, well, that would be an example of one of the outside performers we bring in. We might bring in an animal show, a magician.
Illinois Juggling Institute was another one I saw.
Yeah, that was for Smashbox weekend. He was hanging around in it. Trying to make it more of a festive atmosphere.
But I was wondering, and I know, you know, we don't know where to cut or if we can cut, but there are so many people in the Niles area who are extremely talented, and a lot of people who would actually volunteer to either do reading hour or perform for our kids. If we could maybe look into things like that. I know a long time ago we talked about partnering with businesses and getting them to, you know, work with us hand in hand. but it seems the only thing that came of that is businesses now can come to our library and utilize our facilities. But if we could try to reach out to them and save some of these costs, it would really help. I mean, we don't seem to partner where we receive something that would help us lower our budget or our expenses, rather. I just would like to see us rethink that. And then just for the sake of one of the taxpayers, he was curious about our fall chapter newsletter, which actually has a distribution of $26,000. I showed that the fall chapter costs $6,442. I believe you do that, excuse me, four times a year. So that's about $25,000.
Yes.
And I have to agree, I did mention a year or two ago, it is a beautiful publication, but it's very costly. And I'm sure we could probably do something a little bit less.
We could look into that.
I mean, and it would still be a beautiful publication, just because we can't seem to cut anywhere. And if these few things would be a beginning for us to even think in terms of reducing, that would be really helpful.
I just want to say with chapter one, the purpose of it is mostly that we do hire, have all of these programs here at the library, and but people aren't going to come if they don't know about them. So
well, I'm seeing
almost all of chapter one is to let people know what is going on in their life.
Oh, absolutely, and I think you should continue to inform them. I just think there are so many ways to publicize your events. You can do it for a lot less than this. I didn't say eliminate it, I meant let's be more cost-effective.
Right. Reduce the number of pages, or?
Actually, the quality of that paper is over the top. They don't even use that anymore. It's so expensive. And I've had a lot of experience in the printing industry, so I know that's top of the line.
Right. Well, and I would touch on that. Meet with our vendor. He does meet with them periodically, try to get the vendors prices. He does, and he's done a really good job of that. But
I appreciate
that. Absolutely.
And then I know this has been on our minds for like forever. The visa bill. The only thing, my only concern is this check register has a lot of repetitive words that we don't need. And as I'm looking at visa for $5,960, I'd probably rather know that it's some type of computer or technology items, or it was some other item.
Carolyn.
Is there a way to know that?
Carolyn.
Can I just say one thing to the people that are present? Anytime we have anything on check register, we have the box, this blue box that is sitting over there, and any of the board members can go in there and see the check back of whatever is spent. So it is open, it is, you can all look. So I just want to make that clear to everyone. So Tim does review all the checks to check and balance our whole check register. So go ahead, Tim.
Okay, so my point is, talking about the report that we received.
But you're talking about the visa.
Okay, so. No, my question is, this report that we received is called a check register. It has two columns. For at least 500 lines, if that's how many checks we write, it says accounts payable, accounts payable, accounts payable. Then the next column says computer check, computer check, computer check. I don't really need to see that. Maybe what I would like to see is if there's a way to identify what the vendor is in terms of, is it a budget code? Is there a way to identify the items? That would be more helpful to me instead of searching through a box. I'm just saying our reports, we could try to verify where the information that we look at is more informative. I have no idea why we spent $5,000 on visa, but I'm thinking some sort of breakdown computerized would be helpful.
So
well, you can share whatever information you have.
Sure. So on a monthly basis, right, Barbara and I both with a PDF of all the detail of all of these items, the checks, and the actual invoice of that check. So
could we see that as well?
Absolutely, it's open.
So what was this visa check for?
Well, I have the okay.
Oh, okay.
But, you know, when I look at it, each item looked to me reasonable. I mean, I'm not going to say
okay, thank you. Superior Copies, is that a, that can't be another copy printing company, is it?
I think it's
for $800.
For, do you remember what Superior was for?
I believe in patron services, when there's a lost item and it's lost and paid, we purchased, there's like a carbon copy where the patron services staff fills out, So I think the cost was as high as it seems because we got a big supply of it. The last time that we ordered those were years ago.
Oh, they're printed forms.
Printed forms, yeah. The patron services clerk needs to fill out when there's a lost and paid item.
Okay. I'll be honest with you, all the items I pulled out are either printing or technology. So there's quite a bit. All right, well, that answers, oh, one more. Blackstone Audio?
There's our audio books. The books on CD, I think it is. That's one of the vendors for those. Recording books, listening library, and Blackstone.
See, and that's another thing. If there was a way to categorize items instead of calling it a computer check, I don't know if you could call it... Even if you put CDs, or there's got to be words that you use when you create your reports. And you have to figure out how much money you're spending in different categories. If we could see that, it would help us understand who these vendors are since we don't really recognize their name.
Carolyn, you can come. Tim is the treasurer, but you're welcome to come and look at the sheets.
Oh, no, I'd rather probably talk to Greg about hopefully changing the form.
I had actually, that's an interesting point that you're bringing up. When I first started this, I had exactly the same observation, and I didn't really understand all this. But on that PDF, with the actual invoice and the actual check attached to it, it explains it a lot better. So maybe that will help you.
Actually, I still would like to see if maybe Greg, when things slow down, could look at this check register and create one that includes additional information that would benefit all of us. Instead of repeating words we don't need. We all know this is accounts payable. We all know these are computer checks. That's the only point I'm trying to make. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone else have any other discussion?
I just have one. I know I always focus on the Visa card. Has there been any looking into the cards? Get a card that either offers points or cash back.
We talked about it again last week, but we have not found one yet. But we did have one still on our radar.
Can I just ask a question? Payroll checks are included in what we're approving, or are we disapproving these checks? Like the two, whatever the amount is.
We're approving the payment of the bills, all the operating, payroll, okay. And the operating.
Can I just make one other comment? I know that Director Lemke has hired a few staff members. One was a supervisor for the media lab. And I know this
digital
came
services,
up.
The digital services department, okay. Not just the media lab. Okay.
And I know this came up before. But I will not be approving the checks, and I want everyone to understand why. I contacted the deputy director of the Illinois State Library in Springfield. His name is Mr. Lauren Tucker, and I spoke to him about our process of hiring. He told me, and what he said exactly was, decisions concerning hiring, fixed compensation, and the removal of employees are bar board approval. These decisions occur after board approval. The board meeting does not follow the termination, hiring, etc. of employees. Decisions are made after board approval. He told me that we need to review the Illinois statutes and that all of our bylaws cannot be changed if they do not follow the Illinois statutes. He told me the director does not approve hiring. She receives management responsibilities from the board. The board can only approve hiring. So in essence, this person we hired shouldn't be getting a paycheck because we haven't even approved her.
Statute reads, the board may appoint fixed compensation of a qualified librarian to act as administrator of the district's daily operations. The administrator may hire other employees deemed necessary by the administrator, fix their compensation, remove these employees subject to the
approval of the board.
Correct.
That's the term that counts. We approve whatever she does. She does the late work.
You don't necessarily have to approve each one of them one at a time at a board meeting. That's not what it says. Can't tell me I have permission to hire. And as the printout that I gave you says, that is what is done at all of the other libraries.
I know, which means they're in violation as well. You can call him. He would like to have a conversation with you. Okay, the board approves hiring. That's it. And it's not that complicated. School districts with a lot more employees than you have can do it.
But the village does not do it. I talked to Steve. The village does not approve all of the employees.
I don't know. I don't think he's part of the Illinois library. I don't think he has anything to do with the Illinois library statutes. We do. So I just wanted to share that with you because for 3 months I couldn't get it out. And that's all I have regarding the check register.
All right, we'll look into it. So I think, yeah, I think we're at the, we have a discussion. Okay, Diane, please take the call.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
No.
Jeanette?
No.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Ted?
Yes.
Next on the item, on the agenda is the treasurer's report. Brad, please.
Okay, if you direct your attention to page 30. This is a summary of the financial statements through the 4 months ended October 2015. Revenue for the month was less than budget expectations by $35,000 and the short year-to-date expectations by $71,000.4%. We expect to catch up for budget expectations throughout the year as the shortfall is primarily for real estate collection rates. Salaries for the month, $8,500 short of budget estimates or 3.2%, $99,224 on the year or 9.3%. Library materials for the month, $16,947 over budget or 27.6%, $45,773 over budget or 18.6% for the year. This is due, as usual, to payment of annual subscription fees, where we pay a year in advance, and they tend to come throughout the year. So we'll catch up and get back on track throughout the year. Library operating expenses, $13,500 under budget or 46.7% for the month, $29,752 under budget or 25.3% for year to date. It's due to primarily to slower than anticipated spending on the software and printing lines. General administrative expenses, $6,000 under budget or 22% for the month, $26,000 or 24.5% for year to date, which is due to slow spending in the legal and consultant line items. Employee fringe benefits, $7,300 under budget, 13% for the month, $20,565 or 9% for the year. And this should track with the salary line item that we were under budget. Utilities this month is within $1,500 of budgeted expense, both monthly and year to date. For the month, the net deficit is $424, which is $33,000 favorable to the net budgeted to the budgeted net deficit of $457, and $187,000 favorable or 25.8% favorable. So, any questions?
The last time you mentioned is the net deficit is 424. It's 424,000. I just
correct.
Want to make sure that the video picked that up. It's not 424.
Correct.
It's 424,000.
Correct. But the idea is that we're very close to what we had budgeted
exactly.
Overall.
Okay, but I just wanted to make sure that the video picked up.
Greg, when we budget for library materials annual subscription. Do you do a budget across 12 months on even amounts?
Yes.
Do you ever consider having a specific month that's much higher in order to account for the payment of that in that specific month?
Yeah, I have considered that. The challenge, Tim, is that the renewals of all of these are not always a given thing.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
So we may have something, we may decide that we don't want to have it anymore, and then, we won't renew it, or we'll buy something else in anticipation of something else
sure.
going out that might be cheaper, or, it's really a mixed bag.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I was just wondering about that. Okay. Sounds reasonable. Thanks.
Any other questions? Director's report?
Okay. I gave a speech to the Boy Scouts at St. John's Rebuff. They asked me to come and speak on leadership, and that was kind of a nice treat. They wanted me in particular because they wanted them to hear from a woman on leadership, so I thought that was pretty cool. And while I was there, I said that we love working with Scouts and really encourage them to come in and help us, and I used this the example that there were a couple of Eagle Scouts that are rebuilding the benches outside the library, the memorial walkway there, that are, have the different names of the wars, and this one boy goes, this he was one of the kids that was doing it. So I really enjoyed that, and then they got a bunch of them done in time for the Veterans Breakfast. Veterans Breakfast was a huge success again. It was very well attended, that's always so touching to see the vets, and they really appreciate what the library offers. I go around and give coffee, and I get so many compliments from people. They really appreciate that the library is honoring them in that way. We also
Susan, about how many Scouts were there in Brooklyn?
It's a small group. It's like maybe 12. Yeah, wide age range, too, like 8 to 18, I think. Yeah, they're cute. And then we also have a Korean exhibit going on the third floor that you might want to take a look at when you get a chance. The opening of the exhibit was fantastic. Attended many honoraries were there. The mayor was there. The general consul general from Korea was there. A couple of state representatives. So it was really it was a very big deal. Let's see. I wanted to let you know that in the past there has been a gala for to benefit District 63's after-school program. And this year, there was no gala planned at this time. So if you're wondering why I haven't brought it up, it's because right now they don't have one planned. They're in transition over there. There's a new director of that program. I also wanted to remind you, in my director's report, I always include a little calendar of things that might be of interest to you. The Chamber Christmas Party is coming up on December 3rd. In the past, some of the trustees have attended that. Just wanted to remind you about that. I wanted to let you know that we have been working more with family services across the street at the village, and the staff took over, I think it was 29 Thanksgiving bags last week, which I thought was, that's our all-time record. So it's a little Thanksgiving feast in a bag with each one with a $25 gift card, all of it contributed just strictly by staff members. So it's a very generous and giving staff. They really care about their community. So that was neat. They were very appreciative over there. Kind of a little bit bare over there, so I think they're very glad to get some more supplies. And I also wanted to mention that Family Services has been helping us with, we have, with the economy the way it is, we do have more people using the library here who might have problems of one kind and another, and they might sometimes be a little disturbing to other patrons, but you don't want to be kicking people out who need the library. So we were working with Family Services. Cindy, in particular, helped initiate this, and they came over and helped us with one particular person that was really causing some problems but very much in need, and I just was so impressed by their kindness and their persistence in making sure that they kept working with him until they got him into a program that was helpful. So I was really just very, very impressed with them. So those are those things. I wanted to also mention, we've been talking a little bit about the video recordings of the meetings. I just have to remind the board that we were instructed to start recording the meetings, but you didn't allocate any funds for it. You didn't allocate any staff time. You didn't allocate any equipment funds. So we're kind of doing the best we can, but it is putting a strain on our resources. It's taking a pretty significant amount of time. And then we're getting complaints about the quality of the recording. So I would like the board, you don't have to tell me right now, but I'd like you to think about whether that is something that you would like us to look into hiring somebody more professional to be doing it. We talked with one person just to get a little bit of a feel for what kind of money we were talking with that. But I would like to get some feedback from you maybe at the next board meeting about how important that is to you and if you want to, you know, because we talked before about how the village really invested serious money into their equipment. And so they have wonderful recordings. Ours are, you know, it's pretty home video here. So Sasha does his best, but it's not an ideal setup. So I would like some guidance from the board on that.
Jeanette, you might know better than me, but didn't the village spend like $50,000 on their video?
Yeah, they spent it.
Yeah, it was a lot of money.
I believe the mayor offered to let us use their facilities. I don't know if it comes with cost.
No, he is not. I talked with him the other day when we're talking about possibly that would be something down the road, but if they were to have us use their facilities, would there be a cost attached to that?
That's what I said. I don't know what the cost would be.
And they haven't budgeted for that for next year. Right.
But I have a question in terms of our videotaping. Is that the one that is costly, the videotaping that we do? That's the one that you wanted to discuss about another option, the video, not the audio?
Well, I haven't heard complaints about the quality of the audio, but I have heard you in particular have complained about the quality of the video. So if we want to do better, we're going to have to spend some money.
So did we figure out why there was a problem with the audio when you couldn't hear us? I thought it was just a matter of microphones on the table that we sit at.
Well, we watch the videos, we can hear things pretty well. But we did run out of room on one of the cards, so that was a problem. So we definitely have backups on the cards now.
Well, the meeting when we were discussing the accuracy of our board minutes, that's when I couldn't hear what was going on at that end. Like, the attorney was speaking and I couldn't hear what he said because I really wanted to get that sentence down. I don't know that it's a consistent problem, but I did watch a video today and then all of a sudden the screen popped up and said, sorry for something. And
that was when the card ran out of room, remember?
What did I miss? Okay, I get it. Yeah. All right, so we think we can't better this situation? You think you need to go to something completely different?
Well, I'm not saying that. I just want some guidance from you on how much time that you want to spend on that.
So we'll put that on the agenda for next month. We can have a discussion on whether we would like to invest or do we really want to spend taxpayers' money on that. Let's just,
I would imagine that this particular one is going to be fairly garbled for a lot of what people were saying, because that, you know, that's pretty far away to catch.
I don't know. I've never worked with it, so.
Well, you know, the microphone on the videotape is way over there by Sasha, so it would have to pick up everything.
So do you never videotape in this room? We don't have anything to videotape anything?
Well, we did it just for the veterans breakfast, for example. We set it up exactly like this.
Oh, okay. Because I'm thinking they utilize this space thing.
No, there's no videotape equipment.
Well, I think she said they already did something for the veterans.
We did it exactly the same.
Yeah, using that
camera on the tripod.
Well, then we'll just have to determine. You know, are you done with the report? I just wanted to jump on there.
No, okay. Not quite.
Thank you.
And then I wanted to let you know that when we talked in the past.
Excuse me.
Oh, no, we're done.
Oh, go ahead. Okay.
I'm sorry.
We talked in the past about the computers on the lower level and the guest passes, and so I just wanted to let you know that Susie and her staff of Digital Services have been working on that problem, and they've come up with a kind of interesting solution. They're going to take the first 8 computers, and those are the guest pass computers, and they're right in front of the desk. Because one of the problems that we have is that not all of the behavior that we have down there is not always the best, and it tends to be the people on the guest passes. So those people will be right in front of the desk. They get 1 hour, they don't get to renew it, and then the other computers, a guest pass, won't work on them. So you have to have your library card to use it, and your library card has to be in good working order for it to work. So I think that's going to be, it's going to accomplish some good things. It'll encourage people getting library cards. It will encourage them to keep their cards clean in terms of fines, and it will make them a little bit more accountable because we'll know exactly who they are. So I think that's some good solutions. I like the way that they are implementing that. And so they're also giving now, we're now in a period where they're notifying the patrons about that so that they have time to get used to getting in, to go get their library cards and get all that done. So that was what I had. Do you have any questions for me?
Will we be able to use the one that's on our keychain?
Yes.
That's all I have.
When you had mentioned the videotaping, I mean, right now I have to suggest that we're going to have to think of something, because we want to keep the transparency open, and so I don't think we should even think about discontinuing.
Oh, I wasn't proposing that.
And Karen has some questions.
Oh, I have a question. You mentioned the Thanksgiving baskets that were provided. I think I missed it, but I thought in past year board members were asked to contribute to it, and I don't remember being asked this year. And so next year you want to ask us, because we've contributed in the past.
Okay, well, that's good to know.
I think we knew about it, but I guess too late.
All right, I was going to ask that too. I saw the picture and I thought, weren't even told they were bringing them over, because I know I had gone over a couple of years.
I think that was a Wilson thing. She mentioned she got all of us.
Another question. There's something mentioned here in your report about volunteers. I know a question was, a couple of comments were made tonight, why don't we use volunteers? We do have volunteers.
We do have a lot of volunteers.
And we have adult volunteers and we have teen volunteers too, is that correct?
That's right. Yes.
I didn't ask you this ahead of time, but do you know off the top of your head how many volunteers we have that work for the library?
It's on the statistics report. So for the month of October, we had 91 volunteers, or 79 volunteers doing 377 hours. Depends on what's going on in the library. We have regular volunteers that come in every week. We have special event volunteers.
That equates to about 2.5 full-time equivalents. Full-time equivalent is 150 hours during the month.
And then, of course, in the summer, it shoots way up with all teens doing summer reading for us. So, yeah, we use a lot of volunteers. And, in fact, I was a little disappointed that the gentleman talking about the sewing class didn't mention that my next sentence was, maybe we could find a volunteer.
Yeah, so, and I read that right away, too, when you had that on there. Maybe we can find a volunteer.
Right. No, I think they are definitely looking to get volunteers doing a lot of the working with some of the equipment that we have, because, you know, who knows better how to use that kind of stuff than a high schooler. So, yeah, we do work with a lot of volunteers. It takes a lot of time. Cindy is extremely well organized, and she has it running very, very efficiently and effectively, but, volunteers are not work free, but we definitely do use a lot of volunteers, and we'll continue to do that.
I wanted to make a comment about your last director's report when you mentioned the Wi-Fi hotspots and the increase in the price based on Sprint.
Yes.
There was an article about Maine Township High School, who is working with Sprint, and they will be receiving hotspots for their students, and for a charge of $100 per device, they will provide 4 years of Wi-Fi to all of their students. So I'm thinking at $38 per month per unit, we may want to see if we could latch on to a different program, or maybe get involved like human services for people with issues. There must be something that we can gravitate towards where we won't have to pay such an exorbitant amount of money. I mean, it's a great idea, but there must be some other ideas for us. Because we always seem to be carrying the brunt of the cost, and that was a huge amount. I know I forgot who reported on this, but there were some comments in one of those videos that the other schools are also experiencing this increase. But apparently, Maine Township is not. $100 for 4 years per student, that's a good deal.
How many units?
For every student.
For every student?
Well, not 100 the students. And I'm sure the numbers of students has something to do with the price, but maybe if the cost is prohibitive, maybe that's not something we should be doing.
Well, before we do
that, maybe look into what other options there are.
That's what we're doing. I don't mean to interrupt, but yeah, sure. We did not sign on to the $38. Now we decided that was too steep and we wanted to look at our options. So that's what we're doing.
And I did hear some time ago that the city was also coming up with a program for people who can't afford internet services. So it seems to be catching on. Hopefully there's something for you as well. I just wanted to mention that.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Then communications is next.
Sure.
I just wanted to pass out that we had a particular patron that was trying to use our new digital services in Studio A, and she took a great deal of staff time and a great deal of staff patience, but she did write a really nice card to them, so I just wanted to pass that down. And then, of course, you see that patron comments.
I thought you were going to say she created this card.
No, well, you can do that.
Yes, so
that's all I have for communications besides what is already in your packet with the paper comments.
Okay, any committee reports, building and grounds to meet Barbara?
Yes, we had a meeting of the building and grounds committee, and we discussed a couple of things. First of all, we discussed signage for the building. If you take a good look, you don't have to take a good look, you just look at the building, you can see there's no signage on the building indicating that it's the library. And it's been reported that people have difficulty figuring out if when this is their destination, if they arrived at the library or not. In fact, one woman said she wasn't sure she was at the library until she saw the tiny little numbers over the canopy outside, the address numbers, indicating that in fact she was at 6920 West Oakton. So we're looking into getting some signage for the library, possibly signage on the building. We're going to talk to the village and we're going to consult with them. We're just talking about putting signage on other village buildings. And also we're talking about, we're looking into the possibility of putting up some, what you call, monumental signs. And I don't mean monumental, when I say monumental, I mean a very nice looking sign at a couple of locations indicating that this is the Niles Public Library. Also, the other issue we discussed was the canopy over the entrance. The copper roof over it is leaking, probably because of a flashing problem in the back. So we also talked about solutions for that.
Okay, so thank you. Carolyn, Friends of the Library.
Okay, yes, we had a meeting, I think it was last week. Actually, the topic there was volunteers and the plans for a Christmas luncheon. We received a report about the volunteers. There was some confusion with the hours. I guess based on the different columns, we didn't know how many hours each volunteer had worked, and then they tried to come up with a like a meeting based on so many hours they'd be invited to this Christmas luncheon. So I believe Susan was gonna talk to Cindy and take care of that and get that information to Panusiak so that I guess there'd be some kind of invitations going out. And the only other thing that came up, and I can't really speak totally to it, there was a request for the what's it called? Oh, the travel
no,
books.
Flight or no?
What was it? Travel books or something?
Yeah.
And update the travel collection. And I know Chris asked you a question. I didn't hear the dialogue, but are you not requesting it? I didn't know what happened. What
the board, I had given that to the Friends all the way back in the spring, I think. And they want a lot of control over what we purchase. These were for travel books for the collection. And they want to, you know, control what kinds of books we buy and choose titles. And they wanted a lot of information surrounding it, and I came back to them with a little more information last month, and it wasn't enough for them, and at a certain point, I just have to say it's the job of the librarians to do the selection. I'm not going to ask for money for another group to be choosing the books that go on our shelves. That is strictly a librarian job. So I would have withdrawn the request.
Okay, I believe last month I was there wasn't any information. That's why they asked you to bring the information. It says here you were going to
Okay, well, I don't really think this is appropriate for this setting.
So do you no longer need these? Because I'm trying to figure out what happens with the fulfillment of this request.
I have withdrawn my request.
From them. So do we need them to take care of this as your library?
We have a materials budget, and Cecilia will be purchasing from the materials budget.
Oh, so you can take care of it. Okay, because I just thought, wow, what? Okay, all right, thanks for that.
And the Friends also made a donation to the Honor Flight. So they have done that for the last few years. So they donated $500 to the Honor Flight.
Legislative?
I don't have any legislative or rails.
Or rails. Secretary's report? Hopefully there's anything to report, Barbara?
No, I don't have anything today.
Okay. Next agenda item is new business, so I would like to entertain a motion to approve the closing of the library for a staff in-service day on Friday, January 22nd, 2016.
So I'll second it here in Barbara.
Susan, please just tell us a little bit about what happens at the staff in-service day.
Sure. It is the one day of the year that the staff can all be together in the same room at the same time. For training, we usually bring in a couple of speakers. This year we're actually going to have Tony from the Family Services come over, and he's going to talk with us about the kinds of services that they can offer and how we can help them locate the people that need their help, and working back and forth with them, and give us some tips on, you know, the best ways to deal with people that are troubled, and to get services into the hands of the people that need it, because a lot of them do show up here at the library. And then we will also have another speaker from ALA coming in the afternoon. There will be some staff training, and it's also just a good chance for the staff to kind of get to know each other and their staff awards that are given that day as well. But they're peer-to-peer awards. I have a director's award, and then there's peer-to-peer awards.
I just want to make sure people don't come to the library that day. It's going to be open. It's going to be out on the marquee.
It will be publicized everywhere.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know if you let the schools know in some way.
Oh, absolutely.
Because kids might think they can come here and work.
Yeah.
So I just want them not to make a needless journey.
Yes, no, that is very important. We don't want people to get upset either. So, yeah, we will make sure that everybody is notified properly. And we picked the Friday because that's the day of our lowest attendance.
I was just going to ask this. Thank you. Any further discussion?
Yeah. Where did this come from, by chance?
That is a document that we prepared.
Who prepared? Well, some of it's incorrect. I have to speak up on it because the very first page, the compound and annual growth, where it says Derblick and Matthijs voted to increase the annual raise from 2.4 to 3. But I distinctly asked Linda, but this just tended, we're going to discuss this, right? And I should have known better that we weren't going to discuss it. So that's incorrect. So, and if you listen to the tape, you'll hear it.
Please,
because I asked her at the end of the meeting, we're going to discuss it. There has only been one special meeting budget review in the previous 3 years. You said the last meeting occurred May 29th, 2013. We had a special meeting May 29th, 2014. There were other things on the agenda, but there was discussion of the 2014-15 budget. That's incorrect.
It was not a line by line going through. I listened to that recording.
But
it was a
we still had a special meeting and a discussion, and we went through the budget. Okay, and here where you bring up when you were hired, I did abstain. I remember doing that. And the reason was to find a replacement for the director, last director, that we agreed to spend $40,000 on a national search consultant. The only reason, yes, we did go out for a search, and the reason I abstained, for everyone to know, is it wasn't done properly. And that's what I discussed to you, that
we did go out and spend, and then they just said, no, forget all those resumes, and I just didn't feel they did it the right way. They still should have gone through the interview process instead of doing what they wanted to do.
Well, Danette, the right way is rather a pregnant phrase. I feel we did do it the right way, so that is an opinion, not a fact.
It's my opinion. We didn't do it the right way. Any other, if we're getting interviews or if we should at least interview the people, you never know. But like I said, I abstained and told you, Susan.
I understand.
And it should have been done that way.
After we spent all that money for a consultant, for a director, I was told they couldn't even bring in a candidate who was extremely qualified. President Ryan told me she's not going to get the job. Why would you waste her time? So, I mean, that whole process was not
correctly. But we don't just bring this up now. We don't discuss
this. Because someone had the dispatch sheet, and it needs to be corrected. And I want it for the record that to correct. And I'll read the rest, and then...
Can I ask a question? Can we all then, since we just got this today, all look at it and discuss it at our next meeting?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
You didn't have to ask.
Well, I just thought it would be nice and ask.
Okay, so let's review it for next meeting.
Thank you.
We have a motion on the table.
So we have a motion on the table for the approving of the closing for staff in service on Friday, January 22nd, 2016.
So moved.
You already had the motion.
We
just had the discussion and
then it went into something away from that.
Yes.
So we got distracted a little bit.
So sorry about that. Diane, would you please take it off?
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Danette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Jim?
Yes.
The next agenda item is unfinished business, and I just want to ask Dennis, should we vote on each group change separately, or as a whole group?
Well, I think some of the trustees may have some issues with pressure about specific bylaw, suggested bylaw changes, so I think it would be appropriate to vote on each individual and address it.
As suggested by Bruce's attorney, we will go through each one individually. So the first, we'll go to the bylaws. I'd like to entertain a motion to approve the changes to the bylaws as presented and distributed.
Page 3 is a change to the time of the meeting, and the we just adjusted the regular order, the order of business to reflect our current process. Though I don't know, you may not actually want it to be consent agenda. I mean, the consent agenda the last few months has been getting pulled apart, so maybe you don't want it to be a consent agenda anymore. We were going to change it to be that, but now I'm thinking maybe you don't want to change it after all.
Worked well for most of the time.
Then let's see, on page 6 at the bottom. That is the only substantial change. The other ones are just cosmetic type changes. The only significant change to the policy, to the bylaws, is page.
Wait,
bottom page 7,
we're
6.
Number.
They're on the side like here.
Carolyn?
So the bottom of page 6 is the beginning, and then page 7, that was the one where it talks about how you can change the bylaws. Bylaws are supposed to have some wording that says how bylaws can be changed later. So my suggestion, but it's completely up to you, these are your bylaws,
is that you make it that changes to the bylaws can only be made at a regular meeting of the Board of Trustees with 5 or more trustees voting in favor of the changes. That's just a suggestion. You could make it unanimous, you could make it whatever you want.
Does it have to be a regular board meeting? What if we need to do something? We don't want to wait for it.
Well, I don't think you should be making a bylaws change impulsively.
I don't think it'd be impulsive if something happened. Is that the way it's supposed to be done?
I think that's the whole purpose of this change, so that it's not done.
Exactly.
So right. Is this the way, and here's another thing. Has someone checked the Illinois state statutes? That's what they say, and that's what we're doing, correct? Because otherwise we're going to have to redo all.
Dennis has gone through all of my suggested changes.
There's no state statute under the Illinois Library District that deals with
any of this?
The amendments to the bylaws.
Okay, except that our bylaws, which was about the director being hired as one.
No, that's not a bylaw.
Oh, it's not? Okay.
That's a policy.
Oh, okay, gotcha. So our policies reflect our bylaws? Is that how that goes? Yeah, they don't.
The bylaws are just very basic. The state law says, you know, you need to have these things in your bylaws.
So if I wanted to go to something for direction, do I go to the policy or do I go to the bylaw?
What depends on what you're looking for. The topic.
Bylaws or policy.
Oh, I see. Okay, gotcha. So they're not similar then, right?
Okay. I'm actually in favor of saying unanimous.
So am I.
I would say five.
Otherwise,
it might
be like a hung jury. Yeah, unanimous, one person can accept it.
I thought it was supposed to be the quorum or something. Why five? Isn't it 4 out of 7?
Well, that would be a majority.
Five is a majority. Super majority.
Well, I think when we talked about this, that we tonight, and I remember the discussion on this, we felt that five is one more than a majority. So it's a little bit more stringent.
But if the voting by a board is majority, why would we change it?
Because it specifically targets changing the bylaws themselves, not like everything else.
No, but I'm saying is any voting that's done, it's the majority that rules. Why does this have to change?
Because we felt that it was more important to have a greater number of trustees to change the bylaws. But that was our discussion.
I don't remember that, but I'm thinking if 4 out of 7 constitutes the vote, then it let it go.
Which feel like bylaws are basically your constitution. It's a really important document. Policies can be changed all the time,
just
but the bylaws.
Because you want to change something doesn't mean that 5 people think it's right.
Well, like I just think if you're going to make a change to the bylaws, it should be, you know, very well
okay.
Agreed upon.
Right.
They should not be changed lightly.
I think it's a super majority.
Because the last one was 4.
Page 9.
Seriously.
What about the majority? Oh, well, you guys have to vote on the bylaws. We're not.
That's it for the bylaws.
That's
so
it for the first
yeah,
section.
That's
the motion was for section 2, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So you'd have to vote on that?
Yeah.
Okay. You have a question? Did everybody done?
Yes.
Discussing the potential changes?
That's all I have.
I did notice on page 9.
Oh,
we're
on section 7.
So we have a motion on the floor to keep them as is.
To
accept the changes as is.
As
presented. As recommended by Susan Moon. Correct. That's what I said. Thank you for so are we keeping it with the 5 or 1?
Yes.
Exactly how it is. Okay. All right, then please take a roll.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
So I would like to entertain a motion. So we'll just do it one by one then. Entertain a motion to approve the changes to 3.02 library rules.
as presented and previously distributed. I need motion. Discussion.
Okay, this one, I need, on point six, I have added.
Susan, what page are you on?
I'm on page nine.
Okay, and then eight.
Nine, yes, because we have an additional change to it since the last meeting.
That's why you have 2.6 on there?
That probably, yes, that's right, because one of these, I think, is coming out. So, point six is the addition. It is the one where we specify that adult visitor student use services may be approached by staff to be asked about why they're there. Point six is the one that we talked last time about just eliminating that, that we do, we have reached out to the business community to use the library and have used for the lot, for business quite a lot. The new point is on page nine, in 9A, and that came up, and I had emailed all the trustees, you probably remember that we had the question raised about whether you can distribute certificates.
Yeah, no.
9A, the next one.
9B is a page.
Yeah, because it got inserted after the packet was made. So now point 11 would be, after consulting Dennis's firm, that we cannot tell people they can't circulate petitions anywhere on library property, which is what I said before. It needs to specify, you can't do it in the building, but you can do it out on the sidewalk. My only question to you is if you want to put a specific limit on it, or just have it as, you can't disrupt library operations or impede entering or exiting.
Are you asking that you have a certain number of feet away from the library?
Because some things are like that, but.
Is that what you're asking?
Yes.
Or a specific location on the library property? Like, yeah, and what would the parking lot?
Okay, but this doesn't refer to when there's actual elections here, and people have to have a certain amount.
No, that's separate.
Space to be at.
That's, right. This was somebody in particular wanting to circulate a petition about redistricting.
Is there already some type of parameters about this? I mean, we're not reinventing the wheel. What is it supposed to be?
Point 11, I should have left point 11 on there, I apologize. It said, it said before, you can't do it anywhere on library property. And according to, you know, the people that were here, and now Dennis's firm, that's not legal. We can't tell them they can't do it anywhere. We have to give them some guidance on where they can do it.
Okay, so we're saying outside?
Yes. I mean, if you wanted to, you could say they can do it anywhere, but.
So they can do it inside?
No, the way they wrote it is they cannot do it inside.
No petitions are supposed to be in any of them.
Why would be in the building?
No, that's what I mean, so in the building is.
I think that's right.
Definitely, yeah, definitely, no in the building.
And I did raise the question of, could we say they could be in the vestibule, you know, thinking about if they're like out in the snow or something? But they said that would open the door on the building. Let them in the vestibule, then they can come in the rest of the building. So those are the changes I'm suggesting.
Just a quick question, I think answer it now, but is library a reduced parking purposes?
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, it's okay, my answer is I don't go here. So on those days, the, anyone who can't pay manager has to be at least 100 feet away from the entrance to the library.
Right.
Would it make sense for us to make our policy so consistent with that? Never be within 100 feet of library with campaign materials?
Or the library?
I think the campaign pool.
It's 100 feet from the room where the voting is at, actually, that's true. I don't know what room you use.
So in the fall, zero in the spring, you can see it was, you know, going a few cars outside of the door.
Right, I mean, it just would be consistent with that, so that on election day, any other day of the year, you could be within 100 feet of this room.
Well, where does 100 feet from this room take us?
Actually, when they come to vote, they usually tape off away from the canopy. It's not inside the canopy.
And put that, that's the 100 feet?
Yes.
Wait, so you're saying 100 feet from this room, and where does that take?
It ended the canopy.
Oh, so it's still outside, okay.
It's the parking lot, though.
Right.
So our people could be around the corner.
Or just be not impeding the exit?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not impeding the exit, yeah, I mean, things are going to cause parking.
I
So I think this sounds good to me.
Where are you at now?
I think it's odd.
Yeah. We're on,
Nine.
You need to. Between 9 and 10. Okay. Any other questions?
I'm sorry, back on page 9, I missed. We have two number sixes. They're completely worded different.
Okay.
So my proposal is to eliminate the one that is to do with no portion of the premises shall be used as a place of business. So it would be to eliminate that altogether.
I got you.
So the second one is being eliminated.
Okay, correct. Any other questions?
Okay, thank you.
Just to be clear on the motion, so the motion was presented, as presented, was to approve it, approve the changes to 3.02 as presented. Just so it's clear, as presented means that the recommendation is to strike the second number six located on page 10.
To the extent there was any confusion, I think it was my motion.
Karen?
Yeah, I would accept that clarification, that the motion is to approve the amendment 3.02 as written, except that the second number six is read.
And so you can mark. Take a roll?
Take a roll.
Who seconded that motion?
I seconded.
All right, Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
And I would suggest you combine the next three into one motion because they're just leaving up typos or updating language. So 3.03, 3.04, 3.10, and 3.11.
And I move that 3.03, 3.04, 3.10, and 3.11 be approved. Yes, the question.
So it's pages 10 through 13.
Yes.
Okay, so it's Karen, and the second, Debbie, second.
A second.
Discussion.
I have a question.
Yep.
What is slat wall?
Slat wall is wooden pieces that, it's the wooden pieces where you can hang signs on it. We don't have bulletin boards or anything.
We don't have any bulletin boards?
Not for the public, except behind scenes.
All right.
Or not that we have notices on it, if something is established.
Any further discussion? Was that 3.11?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, take a roll.
Karen?
Yes.
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 Patty?
Yes.
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 I have a motion to approve the changes to 3.14, meeting study rooms, as presented previously distributed.
So moved.
Karen? Second.
A second.
Tim? Any discussion?
Okay, on point D on page 15, it currently reads, smoking is prohibited in all library facilities and grounds. There's a separate smoking policy and that conflicts. So I would suggest that you match the smoking policy, 3.19, which says smoking is prohibited inside the library facility and within 15 feet of a door, window, or intake ventilation system, which is the state law. And then the other, things I don't know, do you know what I'm saying? I added some wording to the study rooms. I took out a couple of just paragraphs that
one thing. On the last item, you have larger rooms. Larger rooms may not be reserved by single individuals.
Yes.
But what if all the other rooms are taken?
Well, that would be up to the staff too, so.
Or go ahead and allow it.
You can't deliberately say, I want this biggest room, so I'm going to want that one.
All right. Just that we reserved a room yesterday, so I don't know. Okay, that's perfect. Any further discussion? Okay, we can, Diane, take roll.
Karen?
Yes.
Yes.
Danette?
Yeah.
Yes.
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 I'm sorry, yes.
Can I suggest combining the 3.16 and 3.29 into one motion, because it is moving the verbiage of 3.16 to 3.29, so we have two different donation policies to eliminate the first of the two policies.
Okay, so I'd like to entertain a motion to approve the changes to 3.16, gives the special donations, and 3.29, give donation, sponsorship, and naming rights policy as presented and previously distributed. Motion?
So moved.
Karen?
Second.
Barb? Discussion?
I just want to read, the text does not change, is that correct?
No, it's just kind of paste it into the other document and being added to it. I like it because it's a kind of a short summary of some of the more detailed information that follows in 3.29.
So it's very what's happening is 3.16 just going away altogether.
Yep.
Yep. It'll just be taken out.
Yep.
And everything will be in 3.29.
Right.
Okay.
I just have a question.
Yep.
Number 8, the library will not accept or deposit materials, or should be or deposit materials? What are deposit materials?
Again, it's for deposit materials, which are not outright gifts.
Deposit to the library.
Well, maybe that's a deposit.
Or deposit, comma, materials which are.
Or deposit materials which are outright.
Yes.
Oh, okay. I just.
So you
read it, comma.
Add a comma. In case.
Okay.
Greg is the
Well, yeah.
Are you? I just remember yours.
Yeah.
Okay. So everyone who's going to be a FOIA officer has to take the state FOIA track, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, any further discussion? Diane, do the roll, please. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Chip?
Yes.
Okay, I'd like to entertain a motion to approve the changes to Section 4, Personnel Policies, Number 4.02, Appointment, which is presented and previously distributed. Motion?
I make it.
Tim, motion? One second.
What page are you on, please?
Page 23.
Who's second?
I still need a second. Second motion?
Second.
Karen? Discussion?
This is to bring the policy in line with what the board previously agreed to when we discussed it verbally, that the job of the director is to hire, your job is to hire the director, and the director's job is to hire the staff. There are a number of things in this policy that get in the way of my being able to do that in a smooth and timely fashion.
Unfortunately, it goes against the Illinois statutes. So I'm confused where you can't do it in a timely fashion because it's been done like that forever.
Have we actually not been following this policy? The policy, if we strictly followed this policy as it is written, I would have to check with you before I posted a position when a shell were quit.
When somebody quits, I think there's conversations with Linda, the president, and that's how things are done.
Linda does not have authority to.
Well, then we're all notified. We've done it in the past. I don't see why you.
You were not following the policy in the past. I want to have a policy that is the one we're following.
There were no hires in this library until they were approved by the board. That's the policy we follow. So I don't know where the confusion is coming from.
It's not a matter of confusion. It's that you weren't following the policy before. Starting with the. Openings occur upon the resignation or termination of an employee and the intent of the board to fill the position. You'd have to tell me that you intend to fill that position. So I'd have to ask you every time a high school page quit.
Well, with Linda
and
Weiss,
before
used to
I posted. I know what Linda did, but it's not what it's not following the policy.
It says our intent. Our intent as board members is to fill vacant positions. Your job as director is to be the manager of the process to do that. And then once you've come up with a candidate, you bring it to us for approval and she starts working.
Yes, but in the past, Morgan said, oh, I don't care about the pages, so we're not even going to do it. I don't want to see the pages in circle clerk, so I don't even bring us those. So your policy, you were not following the policy.
So then we should follow it.
So then you should come up with a policy that is.
We have to come up with a policy based on the Illinois statutes. That's just the way it is.
Well, as I showed you, according to the rail survey of all of those libraries, none of the boards interfere with the hiring of the
staff.
Well,
you know what? You either agree with your friends and neighbors or you agree with the Illinois statutes. If they ask you if we had an attorney.
I agree with my attorney who had said this is appropriate.
Well, this man asked me if we had an attorney and I explained who he was and that we didn't. He says, and you read this to me? He told me to print it. That's what you filed.
You know, we're getting sort of this third-hand report of what's
going on. So why don't we have our attorney contact him and see if the story changes? That's fine with me. I mean, I don't know what to tell you. It's an Illinois statute. He gave me the number 75 ILCS 1630-55. I mean, I don't know what else to tell you guys. It says right there.
Maybe the thing to do is have me look into see if there's any cases that have interpreted that language specifically.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what was that?
I'm suggesting that I do some research to determine whether or not there's any cases that have interpreted that language and what they're required to do. And then make a determination.
Well, Well, I think when I explained our interpretation, he told me we were wrong, so if he's in charge, he's from Jesse White's office, who is there else in the office?
Different people have different interpretations, that's why you have judges.
I think, I would like to know what he thinks for us.
So an interpretation that someone else has would supersede the law, is that what you're saying?
Would supersede.
I'm saying it's a judge's job to interpret what the statute means. There's occasionally cases out there that all the time that interpret legislative.
Okay, so if a judge interprets this differently, then we're losing. Who do we abide by? Is Jesse White not the person that we follow?
You follow the law, and the judges may determine what the law is.
I dare say that all these other electors can be wrong.
But are you talking?
I would say, I think the best due diligence is to have our Dennis look into it, and not vote on it tonight.
I'd like to table.
Yes.
I would like to.
Right, second.
So there's a new motion to table item 4.02 to the next regular board.
Yes.
So, okay, so who's the motion? Karen?
Karen.
And who is the second?
I second the motion, or.
Do we have any, do we have any discussion on that?
Let's table it.
No, we table it.
Okay, so we'll table that, who's in favor, all in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Aye.
The unanimous aye.
So just wish you gave us all the libraries.
Yes, ma'am.
So we are the only library, because every library says no, 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 so we're the only library.
Of the people that replied to that question, the Rails FastPath survey, yes.
Because I mean, it just seems that it was the libraries, now, yes.
Well, table it here. We would like to entertain a motion to approve the changes to 4.06 sick leave as presented and previously distributed.
Page are we on now?
It's 45. A motion?
So.
Karen?
Second.
Patty? So discussion?
Yeah, this one just has, I added the verbiage on line 4, without approval from the library director, because the way it stands now, you simply cannot take sick time during the training period, and as I said before, I don't want sick people coming to work. So if somebody, you know, is sick enough that they want to get approval, I'm going to, they're having sick time. The second thing is I just moved a line that was lower in the document, closer to where I thought it made sense.
Diane, take a roll, please. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Matt?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Jim?
Yes. Can we lump some of the other ones together?
Well, I think you are going to want to discuss the next one, but hopefully we can lump some more. There are two A lines.
Page 26. Page 26. Entertain a motion to approve the changes to 4.08 vacation allowances as presented and previously distributed. Motion.
So.
Barbara. Second.
I second.
Okay, on the vacation allowances, the director and the assistant directors are not listed in this anywhere, and I believe that at executive level positions, they should just automatically get 4 weeks of vacation. I think that's a thing that you would use in hiring people. I don't think it's appropriate to make somebody at this level wait a year to get their vacation.
Excuse me, that was my question. What was it before?
It's not there.
It wasn't.
They aren't listed at all in this list. So, yeah. So I wanted to add that because Greg is the one that is in the position where it affects him, and I think it would be ridiculous to make him wait 4 years to have 4 weeks of vacation.
as a hiring feature, I think that's just something, I would never want to try to hire somebody at that level and not give them a full modification. And then the only other change is just that we used to have forms at the library record sign, we no longer have those forms, I don't. That's just.
Can I ask a question? The 4 weeks, when is it available?
It's accrual, so you earn it as you go. So you would like, boom, you're hired, you've got 4 weeks of vacation, and it would be accruing like the others.
Okay. We look forward. Okay, any further discussion?
I don't know, how does this occur with a library? What do you know?
I don't think it breaks them out typically by position. I could call around, but the Laconi survey specifically says, it says how much the director typically gets, and it's, the director is always 4 to 5 weeks, I don't think there's anywhere that it says what the assistant director's.
So, who's the assistant director now, Cindy?
There are grade two is what I'm considering to be an assistant director. I'm grade one, they're grade two, they're both on the assistant director level.
When does Greg's position turn to assistant director, change to assistant director? Is there a business manager?
He is a business manager, he's on the assistant director level.
Right. He's on the assistant director, he's grade two. If you prefer, it could be grade two.
So
grade one and grade two for me.
Okay, so it's clarified. We say director, assistant director, business manager.
And I'm just curious why we have to add assistant director to business manager, is that?
Okay, I don't want to have that discussion right now.
Well, it's not here, and I wasn't aware of it. He's been a business manager since I've been on the board, now he's an assistant director. Can you just clarify why?
Linda, do you want me to get into that at this time?
No, well, I mean, if you're going to sneak it through and not tell us.
We can just put it in.
What does he get by getting that attachment?
I don't know, I'm trying to figure out their additional duties, why do we need to do it? Actually, I thought being business manager was above an assistant director.
But I would say director, assistant director, business manager.
So, but what is the purpose?
Business manager.
Linda, you had a purpose for doing this, what was it? She mentioned to me tonight that Greg Fritz is not just a business manager, but he's an assistant director. And I'm trying to figure out why, from
she was
all
just
the.
Just saying on the same level.
But now, no, he's listed on his title. We used to call him business manager. So are we giving him more responsibilities that we put it in writing? He's an assistant director slash business manager.
Because if you really do want to get into this now, Greg's position has expanded a great deal. When Mark Cruiser left, we reconfigured the people that were reporting to the different departments. He now is the operations manager of the library as well. He handles all the infrastructure departments as well as business and marketing. His responsibilities have increased without a pay increase. And I thought that he should have the same title as the other assistant director because the staff were confused. You thought business manager was higher. They thought business manager was lower. I thought it clarified things. That's the only thing behind it.
Well, and now to tell you, we talk about being transparent. What was the big secret here? Couldn't you have told, why did we have to wait to tell me? Okay, so now I understand why Greg has a 57th character title. I just wanted to know what it meant. Thank you for the clarification.
So can we leave it as it states then? If we're all okay with it? Carolyn? Yeah, can we leave it as it states then? Are we all okay with how it's stated now?
What are we talking about?
This page.
About the director and the assistant director.
We have a motion to accept. Yeah, yeah.
So we don't want to include the business manager in case his title changes?
I'm okay with. We can add.
I mean, it changed overnight. What if it goes back and then there's Greg?
All right.
She's only thinking of you, Greg. You know that.
What is your business
card look like?
Yeah.
It's like business assistant director.
two.
Yeah, so we'll make it director, assistant director, business manager. Is that what we're leaning towards?
Sounds good.
Okay. All right.
So what will be the motion?
Who made the motion? It was Karen and...
Oh, somebody else. Was it Barb?
Yeah.
Barb.
Oh, it was Barb.
Barb, is that an acceptable change to you?
Yes.
I don't, that's good.
All right, so Diane, take a roll, please.
Carolyn? I'm sorry, Karen.
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yeah.
Barbara?
Yes.
Andy?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
I would like to entertain a motion. Can we put the next two together? At the bottom of page 26. Okay. Entertain a motion to approve the changes to 4.10, leaves of absence without pay, as presented and previously distributed. Motion, please.
So moved.
We'll give it to the bottom of page 26.
It was part of our last query.
Yes, okay, thank you. Karen, has a motion. Do I have a second?
A second.
Tim?
Okay, Kleinthorpe has added some extra verbiage in here to do with FMLA leave. The only change that I made was to allow people that have had a baby to use sick leave as part of their time for FMLA. Those are the only changes.
Wait, I'm sorry. We're on page 27?
Correct. 27, 28.
So that's, I don't know. Oh, I see.
I know, yeah.
Any questions, any concerns?
I had a question for Dennis. Dennis, you suggested this change on page 27, is that correct?
One of our labor partners.
And is this a change in the law regarding, we're doing a change in the FMLA regarding caring for service members with a serious injury?
I believe so, Karen. You can double check that if you'd like, but that recommendation came from the partners.
Yeah, I was just wondering, because I guess it really wouldn't really touch my vote, but I mean, normally there's only certain family members that you can take leave for, and this says any family member. I don't know if it spans the class.
Why don't we table this to the next regular meeting to give the answers? Sounds good.
Table it?
Table it.
Okay.
Table it.
Table it.
So the motion to table 4.10, leave of absence, no. Yes, leave of absence without pay. To the next regular board meeting.
Second.
Barb.
So.
Okay, entertain a motion to approve the changes to 4.13, attendance of professional meetings.
You could do it together with 4.14.
And 4.14, travel expenses, as presented and previously distributed. Motion, please.
So moved.
Karen? Second?
A second.
Tim?
Okay, the change in number four is just that I don't want to make a flat rule about who goes to, you know, if you go to PLA, you go to ALA, I don't think that's appropriate. That just needs to be on a case-by-case basis. On point six, I have struck out that they must have board approval before making a commitment to be on a committee. That is up to an individual. I have added the wording saying you can make that commitment, but we are promising we'll pay you to go.
Okay.
So let's balance that out. On 4.14, this is a change, this is reversing a change that was made by the board a couple of years ago, so that the board was approving individual travel requests, like say one of the children's librarians wants to go to the Association for Library Service to Children conference, and the board would have to approve that. I feel that you approve the budget, you tell me how much I can spend, and then I decide who goes where.
I think that's more appropriate.
Well, again, I think the purpose of the board is to keep track of spending, and that's why they implemented this, because travel can really cost a lot, like we noticed when we went to San Francisco.
As Susan said, we give her so much to spend, and she knows how much she has to spend, she can decide.
See, that's the problem. Remember, we have a budget, we never even cut 5 cents. Somebody needs to be watching what we spend. Just because you have a budget, you can't spend it all, just to get rid of it.
I don't think so. The point of getting rid of it.
I said, people on campus to get rid of money.
Well, you know what, you spend a lot of money, and you don't realize there's benefits, there's salary.
I do realize.
You know, so I think that's why the board changed this, so there's control over spending.
Can I say something? I'm just saying, in the past, I mean, since I've been on the board, has there ever been anyone that we haven't been approved to go to?
Probably, there have been discussions.
Honestly, I honestly don't think there have. So I think that we've approved all of them, even after this policy has changed, and just to be honest, I'm just trying to be honest.
Well, I don't know, I'm remembering Linda Weiss bringing things to us.
No, I'm just saying, even after the policy has changed, I don't think there's anything that was ever brought to us. I personally, if Susan said Donna Block needs to go to ALA, because I don't know what sessions are happening, I'm not sure why she would rather have Donna go over, you know, a different librarian, I would be able to say, yes, you're so right, I have to trust Susan or the department heads to make that decision.
We don't need to micromanage.
You mean to select who goes?
To select who goes.
Well, that's not, I'm talking about dollars, not who goes.
But if you're saying there's X amount of dollars a year to go to conferences.
Can I ask this, do the employees have to present to you what the reasoning is behind the?
Yes, the form that they fill out says what they're going to get out of the conference. And I sometimes ask follow-up questions too.
Right, so if there's a purpose and there's reasoning after they go to that, I would think the department head and their chair would, and the director would know best. And honestly, since I've been on the board, nothing has ever been denied. So why we would have to approve that as long as she's within the budget, I would have to.
I think it was cause to limit spending or decrease spending.
Well, then we do that.
Then we do that at the budget.
But we don't do that. Remember, we blew that this year, so now there's no.
Well, there's next.
You know, Carolyn, that's, again, that is, that's a term.
But that's why this is here.
But see, I don't agree that we blew that.
We have 4 months.
How much is our travel budget for our?
I would have to look at the budget.
Exactly.
Well, do you know every line in the budget?
Okay, Carolyn, we already.
Nobody knows every line in the budget.
You have 4 months to go over the budget. Carolyn.
I'm sorry, what was that?
We had 4 months to go over the budget and talk about it.
No, please, Linda.
Carolyn.
You guys, do you not do budgeting on your jobs?
Carolyn, are we gonna discuss this at every meeting?
Well, every time Linda lies about it, you bet.
Oh, wait, excuse me, we took a vote, and it was passed. That's done.
So now we need, so now there's why we need to watch.
Right, but it was a majority.
Thank you.
It was a majority, 6-1. It was a majority.
That comes up again in the spring, then we'll deal with it again.
We will, however, right now, there is a budget.
Proposal to accept this.
Okay, so, any further discussion?
I do. Are we on, we're still on the travel expenses?
Yes.
Right. Are we gonna adhere that, you know, and that's for anybody, not a trustee, everybody. Actual expenses not to exceed 50 per day?
That has been the, for like 20 years.
No,
we never reimburse people over that.
It's per diem you're talking about.
Correct.
Yeah, per day, okay, well, all right. Can we also, because, when receipts are turned in, because you know I look in the box, so, that if someone does have a meal, they don't just turn in the charge slip that they signed, they have to get the itemized.
Okay.
You know, because
I think that's fair.
Because I did see.
It should be going in now.
Yeah, it should. I mean, that for legality reasons. But, you know, when I did look and I did just see the sign thing and it was like, you know, almost almost $70 for one meal, and I thought, what the hell?
But we would never reimburse somebody $70 for one meal, just to be clear. I don't know.
But I'm saying the itemized. You can't just do the signature.
Are you telling me that we reimburse without an itemized slip for lunch? That's not even part of the IRS procedure. You can't do that.
I don't understand. Don't you just, when I go to, on a business trip, I get a receipt from the restaurant for $8.
That says your food, right?
That says I ate a sandwich and you had two drinks of wine, or does it say nothing?
It's a Visa receipt.
Yes, but no, what I had seen was when it comes out, it's just, I have one in my purse. It's where it gives you just the total and you sign it and off you go. It doesn't show what you have.
All reimbursements.
Could we consider that to be a procedural thing and not worry about it in terms of policy? Because if that is what you want, certainly we can be.
No, it's not what we want. It's the law.
It's not the law.
And you cannot, those are not reimbursable.
You're out over your skis. You're incorrect.
No, I know it's not, because we could never, our auditors pull that all the time. So now you're telling me you don't need to.
What they're doing was fine, and they look at the receipts.
So it's fine for you to get a receipt for lunch, not be able to determine food from liquor?
You mean the IRS wants to know if I had a chicken sandwich or a turkey sandwich?
No, when you're not supposed to be paying for alcohol beverages, yes.
We don't.
How else do you know? How do you know what a $70 bill?
Do they want a calorie count too?
I'm sorry, I don't know where you all come from, but I've never worked for a company that allows this. Only in the library is anything acceptable. So fine, pass it.
Certainly I work for government companies before, and there's a per diem, and there's sort of an assumption that you are probably going to spend that much. And in fact, in many places, when you go for conferences, it's really hard to eat three times a day for this amount. So I really think it's pretty reasonable.
There are many places that just give you the money. They don't ask you for your receipts. They just give you the thing.
Well,
just
figure I don't know about
you're
today.
Getting your per diem, and you just hand it off.
I've never heard
but of I'm that. Not proposing that.
Okay, so if we can take a roll thing. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
This is the last one. Okay. Entertain a motion to approve the changes to 4.15 electronic communication use policy as presented and previously distributed. Motion, please.
So moved.
Karen? Second. Patty? Discussion?
So this is the one where I was just trying to update it to more current practice that, you know, we do have, all have computers here, and a lot of these restrictions were, so you weren't using up too much bandwidth and things like that, and these are just out of date. All of the things that I've lined out are things that we don't need to be restricting people. Certainly everybody checks their personal email, all that are work, and it doesn't hurt anybody. So these are all along those lines.
I just note that Cook County just amended its email policy or computer use policy, which applies to like 25,000 employees, and deleted the prohibition against using it for personal use, because there is really, I mean, it's just so prevalent. Everyone uses their computer briefly during the daytime for personal use. So I think that our policy should align with reality. And I think you can still discipline abuse of the computers for personal use, or people spending just not doing your job. I mean, that's it. You just want them to do their job.
I agree.
Any other discussion?
I'm sorry, so what's the terminology going to say?
It's just struck out some particular lines that are saying.
It's on page 35.
So you're eliminating it, you're not saying.
I'm not adding anything. I'm just taking out lines like using the internet to access personal email accounts with personal email providers is not permitted, which means that I can't check my Gmail account for work. And that's just something.
So you're just taking it out. Okay. No, I thought you were replacing it with something.
No, it's just writing out some old stuff.
No,
it's
31 through 35. Okay, Diane, can you take a roll, please? Here.
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, the next agenda item is to go into executive session to discuss the appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the Niles Woods Library District to discuss minutes or closed session meetings. Do we have a motion? Table, Patty?
I second the motion.
Please call roll. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Is time? 10:43. And we are now reconvening the regular meeting at the Niles Woods Library District Board of Trustees. Please call roll.
Karen?
Here.
Carolyn?
Here.
Barbara?
Here.
Patty?
Yes.
There it is.
Okay. The next item on the agenda is public comments. Okay, no public comments. Any other? Any other?
Nope.
Okay. Motion to adjourn?
Second.